Having a great day. My name is Ben David. Before I go further, I need to perform a sound check. In the left-hand margin, you will see a chat window. Can a few of you please type yes or why if you can hear me? Okay, great. A few more logistics before we begin. If the audio is not clear or if you hear an echo, try logging off Adobe Connect, then log back on. Unfortunately, there's not much else we can do to troubleshoot any audio or video issues you may be having. Secondly, you can find our contact information details located in the lower hand corner of the notes section. Please take some time now to jot down that information. There is also a full screen option of Adobe Connect if the images you see are smaller than you prefer. However, keep in mind that this will disable the chat function. At this time, I wanted to mention some of eSignal's special offers. eSignal has a special offers page at www.esignal.com/specials. Two of the offers we're highlighting right now is you can get eSignal Premier for only $99 a month, which is one-third off the retail price. We're also offering a fall special where you can get eSignal for 3 months free. And today, Option Monster has a special offer for Black and Black. Complete the coaching application found at this URL, which is www.optionmonster.com/coaching. Write eSignal Webinar Attendee in the essay section, and you'll receive a free one-on-one trader assessment consultation and a 250 voucher toward any of our Option Monster educational programs, which I believe is a great deal. Lastly, I wanted to mention that eSignal offers a plethora of learning programs. We offer classes in eSignal 12, which is our latest version, in either basic or advanced training. We offer classes in trading Forex and futures, and we also have a listing of multiple live and online events that can be found here. There are more webinar and events that can be found on the eSignal Learning page. With those details aside, let's begin our presentation today with John Dr. Jay Najarian of Option Monster. John Dr. Jay Najarian is founder of Option Monster and co-lead analyst for the Inside Options Trade Idea Alert Systems. He spent the first 29 years of his trading career trading in and around the pits of the Chicago exchanges. John is a frequent contributor to CNBC, The Wall Street Journal, and other prominent financial media organizations. Mr. Najarian also co-developed the patented trading algorithm, the Heat Seeker, used to detect unusual trading activity. During John's presentation today, you will learn about the results of the 2014 midterm elections and what exactly it means for the broader market, where the opportunities lie, and how to capitalize on them using various option strategies, how to play these opportunities in both directional and non-directional way, defining an exit plan for these strategies, and how to remain disciplined during turbulent market moves in a competitive edge when the VR signals the moment buyers have turned to sellers or sellers to buyers. Gain a competitive trading edge as the VR is a versatile market, versatile across all markets, stocks, ETFs, and futures. Focus in and apply the powerful VR to all trading timeframes from 5 minutes to monthly, and much more. In order to keep John's presentation flowing well, I ask that you please hold your questions till the end of the presentation. Please go ahead and send your questions through the chat box, and John and I will respond in due time. With those final details aside, please welcome Jon Najarian. And again, thank you for attending the Back in Black webinar. Jon, off to you.
Thank you, Ben. Great to be here, folks. For those of you on the West Coast, like Ben, my apologies that it's so early. 6 in the morning seems pretty early, but I believe eSignal is also recording the event. And if you need to go back over some things, I'm sure you'll find that they have access to it for you, so that if you're a little cloudy at 6 in the morning, you can pick it up later and perhaps reinforce what you're hearing and learning today. Again, I'd like to thank eSignal. There's a bunch of other great speakers that are on the board for Back in Black today, and I think all of them would join me in saying I applaud you for learning more before you're committing additional capital to the markets. I think there are great opportunities. There have been already this year, and boy, we're just a month away from one of the greatest opportunities in the last several years, which was that fantastic or horrible sell-off October 15th and 16th when it hit its zenith, when the volatilities peaked, and when the fear was as high as it had been in years, the market turned and burned to the upside. Our market, the German market was down to, I think, 8,700, folks, and it turned 300 points on that one day. Keeping in mind that that's half the value of our market, the German market, that is, the DAX, in terms of it's an 8,000-point index and ours is a 17,000 or whatever. When you look at that, then that's like a 600-point flip in our markets. So that was a massive move. And I think a lot of the opportunity that came our way came because people were levered on the long side in crude oil and on the short side in bonds. And we had that confluence, that both of those events coming together on that same day, the 15th of October, which created that large opportunity on that massive sell-off, 300 and some odd points, for us to flip back to the other side. But enough about that. I'll touch on a couple of the stocks that I do still favor as far as trades. But as most of you know, what my brother Pete and I do is we run that system that Ben was talking about, the heat seeker, and we're looking for unusual activity. Believe it or not, even though Pete's my younger brother, and by the way, after these events today, if you want to watch him, he's on ESPN Goal Line all day today. This will be his 13th week, I think, of being on Goal Line. He basically breaks down every Division I game and shows highlights. It's much like the college football version of the NFL Red Zone. It's a great way to watch college football because you more or less are seeing every scoring play from those teams, the Division I teams. And there are, of course, a bunch of good games today. But what might surprise you is I'm the older trader than Pete by 6 years, and I trade in and out every day, whereas Pete does the same, but he also holds positions. He's the younger guy. You'd think he'd be more quick twitch and in and out, but obviously this has served him very well because Pete has been in Yahoo, and if you've been watching him on Fast Money, you've heard him talk about Yahoo and Alibaba, and these are two trades that he's been in for since Alibaba came out, first of all, and in the case of Yahoo, since it was in the 20s. And unfortunately, I've been in both and out of both because when stocks make a quick move, I'll take it. Some of you are longer time horizon traders like my brother Pete. He's one of the few people I know that kind of combines the short or the quick twitch trading along with that longer term and does it successfully because those are two different skills. But I'll show you how I think you can hold on to some of those trades longer. And the first slide I have here is an example just from the week after that debacle in the markets. This is from, as you can see on our screen, it's from our blog, October 23rd. This is what our clients get when they subscribe to our Inside Option Pro service. We're looking for unusual activity, and then we're trying to wrap a story around it as to why we're seeing that unusual activity. In this case, I was talking about Microsoft and Amazon. They both had earnings on the 23rd after the bell. And I won't read it verbatim, but basically we were looking for the upside in Microsoft and the downside in Amazon. And this is part of what we wrote up that day. And if you go to CNBC.com and feed in my name and type AMZN or MSFT, you'll see Melissa Lee, Herb Greenberg, and I talking about this in depth on CNBC, where on Earnings Squad, I said, well, she said, what would you rather, Doc? And I said, I think Microsoft trades up strong, and I think Amazon, if they don't post a 55-cent loss versus a 74-cent loss, they break 300. The stock was about 314 at the time. Amazon did indeed post a loss of, I think, close to a dollar. So that was double what everybody was looking for. The puts we were long blew up in our favor, and the stock traded down to 275. If you've seen Amazon for the past few sessions, you've seen a phenomenal move back to the upside. And luckily, not only did we take off this trade, and all of this is, you can, again, if you put my name into CNBC, you'll see the videos, as well as if you're a subscriber to our services, you would see that when we saw this unusual activity hitting to the upside after the earnings, after they flushed all these people out, when everybody turned bearish on them, we had Bob Peck from SunTrust on the show with us the day after this particular event. And Bob convinced me that this was a great opportunity. We started to see accumulations of the 290 and 300 calls. And so what we did was we set ourselves up with a call vertical spread to take advantage of the potential bounce back after that hideous sell-off of about $40 that Amazon had just experienced. Those are the kinds of trades you can do with options that, you know, for instance, I think I put on a 15-point wide spread. So like, for instance, 290, 305, that would be an example of that. And instead of having 1,000 shares of a $300 stock or a $285 stock at that time, so instead of having 285,000 on the line, I was able to put that spread on for, I think, about $3.40. So let's call that $3,400. Again, every option's for 100 shares of stock. So $3.40 means 340 per spread. So 10 of them, $3,400. And obviously, with the stock running to 327 yesterday, I was out of the last of that because, you know, you get a phenomenal move like that. I think it's smart to take the money off the table. In the case of Microsoft, if you look over on the right side of that screen, what you're seeing there is the HeatSeeker. I only showed you a quick little bar of it, but you can see from the 23rd of October, this is what we were citing for our subscribers. I was looking for blocks, filtering for blocks of 500 or more going into the earnings. And as you can see, I see going up on the NASDAQ, the NDQ, a quantity of 4,200 of these trading for 20 cents. So now the stock, as you can see on the far right side, it says UND PICS, underlying price, 44.81. So with the stock at 44.81, the underlying price, people were buying calls that would expire the next day, the very next day, Friday the 24th, because as you can see, it says Microsoft 24 October 14, 46.50 calls. Well, so these are a call that is approximately $1.70 or 80 cents out of the money that people are paying 20 cents for ahead of the event and doing it in big blocks of 4,000. 4,000, by the way, is 400,000 share equivalent. Whoops, I don't think I'm moving those.
Hi John, this is Ben from eSignal. A few folks were commenting that the slides are not moving, and I mentioned that I was going to let them know that you're still talking in the middle of the conversation. So for now, folks, let John finish before he asks me to move to the next slide. Sorry, John, go ahead.
Okay. And no, that's okay. So that's enough said about that one, and I will move to the next slide in 1 second, folks. But in particular, when you're seeing these unusual blocks, this is what triggers me and Pete to say this is unusual activity. We're seeing buyers on the offer or sellers on the bid in large institutional blocks. And that's what we publish throughout the day on Inside Options Pro. So I just wanted to let you guys see that because you don't usually get to see that even on Fast Money. This is Alibaba from September. And this is what we were just writing up as far as to try to give our folks an idea of why we figured the price that a given security would trade for. In this case, what we're watching for here is what we're thinking is going to be that very large opening for BABA and why we thought that it could go into the 90s. And as you can see, we were writing it up before BABA was going public. Here's another example, and I'll try to wrap a strategy around this one about Tesla. So this is day after the election, November 5th, 2014, so just a couple weeks back. were looking at Tesla, and the bears were prowling and growling in this one. I'm more than happy, by the way, to trade on the bearish side of the market. I'm more than happy to do that because when we see unusual put activity, the stocks, as you guys have heard us say many times, take the steps up and the elevator down. You get rewarded fast by being right to the downside. And when you are playing, especially with a stock like Tesla, if we wanted to bet to the downside, one of the smart ways to do that, of course, is with either direct ownership of a put. That's simple. We just own a put. It's an insurance policy. It becomes worth more money as the stock becomes worth less. Or a put spread, just like a call vertical spread. A put spread, an example of that, might be if Tesla's trading $230 a share, we buy the 225 puts and we sell the 215 puts. That would be an example of a $10 put spread, where if the stock burps and trades to the downside hard, those 225 puts kick in. That's the one we own, and we've mitigated a good portion of the volatility compression and the time decay by selling the 215 puts of the same expiration. Now, one of my favorite ways of playing into an earnings, however, is to take advantage of that pumped up volatility that is evident in the front. In other words, in the very nearest term, if it's got monthly options or if it's got weekly options, this would be the very week of expiration. Those options will usually be anywhere from 100% to 200% higher volatility than normal. The next week out, we can take advantage of that very high pump by, for instance, if I want to set up a bullish trade, I would be buying, for instance, the 230s in Tesla in next week's time frame and selling the 235s in Tesla in this week's time frame. Because when the volatility compression happens after earnings, you'll see that front, in other words, the weekly option that would expire, that will get crushed the hardest. The one that's out there a week into the future will also be hit, but not nearly to the same extent, and it wasn't 200% higher than it should be. So you get that effect of the volatility working for you instead of against you. It's one of the reasons why, in that example previous, when you see Microsoft, a call that's $1.70 out of the money, trading for 20 cents, that's like a binary bet. You're either right or wrong, and that option's going to be worth zero, or it's going to be worth whatever the in-the-money amount is that very next trading day. A lot of us don't want that much risk on the table, so we set ourselves up with spreads. Anyway, in this one, we do what you guys can all do. You take a look at the straddle. Trade Monster platform is a great way of doing that because we've got 15 different strategies built into the platform. You just click on straddle, for instance, and it'll tell you that November 7th expiration straddle was trading at $22.50. Well, then you just divide that by that price of the straddle, $230, and you're saying, okay, we're expecting movement up or down of this amount, you know, so many percent, and that percent is determined again by just taking the value of the straddle, dividing it by the strike price of the straddle. So $22.50 divided by 230, and it tells you how much movement we're expecting by that expiration. So what we did was we noted for the subscribers that the 210 and 215 puts were being sold in big numbers, that we were seeing 500 lots and 1,000 lots trading and 750 lots trading of these puts. And if you think about that, what the person who's doing this is taking advantage of is that volatility pump that I spoke of. So they're saying volatility is high, and somebody, because how many times, folks, have you heard somebody on CNBC, a guest or a panelist like me, say, well, boy, I'd love to buy this, but I'd like to buy it $5 cheaper. Well, that's kind of a useless statement, because how do you ever get the opportunity to buy it $5 cheaper? And when it trades there, usually people run. In this example, what those people are saying is, boy, I'd like to buy it, and I'd be willing to buy it with the stock trading at $230. I'd be willing to buy it $15 cheaper. And by the way, I'm going to get paid for that. So they could step in there and sell those puts and collect a big fat premium. That is, in my mind, a smart way to trade, as long as you've got both the guts and the money to buy the stock if it trades down to that level, because you're obligating yourself. You are the house. You are being Warren Buffett at that point. You're the insurance company. You're Geico. But the good news is that Warren Buffett is one of the largest put sellers on earth. Warren Buffett for years has made billions of dollars selling puts, not just with insurance. He also does it and did it for years by selling puts on blue chip companies. I think this is a fabulous way to trade. By the way, Bill Gates and Michael Dell were also huge put sellers in the day because they understand that you're being the house, you're collecting that premium. At times, especially when volatilities are high, you're saying, I think the market is improperly pricing this insurance premium, so I'm going to take advantage of it. So anyway, they sold these puts. I sold these puts. Many of our subscribers sold these puts. Those that didn't have quite as much conviction sold put spreads. Again, the example that I cited earlier, selling the two, or you could, for instance, sell the 225 put and buy the 215 put. That's a $10 put spread. You keep that entire premium if 225 or higher is where Tesla is. Well, Tesla did do exactly that. It rewarded all the put sellers, and we kept the premium. It only had to carry it 2 days. And yet that's not a way that a lot of folks are comfortable by having to sell puts to make a buck. But for me, I've made a lot of money in Amazon and in Baba and in Microsoft and in a lot of these other stocks by selling puts when I think they're too high. And I just did it this past week in McDonald's and in, what was that other one? Disney. Those were opportunities. Whoops, I just got to, I'm going to say later. Sorry about that, folks. One of my scans is going off on the computer. Let me flip to this next screen for you guys. This one, also from this year, Allergan. I think many of you were also probably upset by how this played out because this was, of course, Mr. Ackman. We were citing this unusual activity because the maker of Botox had this very strong activity in its underlying stock, unusual accumulation of stock, and upside call buying like crazy. As it turns out, of course, the company that was going after these guys and Mr. Ackman were buying both stock, and in the case of Mr. Ackman, he was buying upside calls. So we said, hey, let's set ourselves up with this simple call spread. So we're saying we saw the 125 puts being sold for $1.15. So that's, again, a Warren Buffett type trade where they understand the risk that an insurance company takes and they sell those puts. And then here you see the 150 calls being bought for $1.55. So the net between those two means somebody's only putting 40 cents on the table, even though they've, of course, obligated themselves to buy if the stock should drop. So they put that on, and then Allergan makes this monstrous pop to the upside, as you guys recall, and they are rewarded in spades, and Mr. Ackman made almost $1 billion on that trade between his stock position and this huge option position that he put on. And it's a question, of course, as to whether or not they do get investigated for some of the things that they did by putting this position on. But take a look at what some of the smartest traders on earth are doing. That guy wanted upside, and he was willing to buy the calls. But instead of paying $1.55 straight out, he, in this case, because there's plenty of she's out there that do this too, but in the case of Mr. Ackman, because he admitted this was him doing this trade, and or when you see this happen, by the way, folks, frequently, it's not the actual trader themselves. It is the Credit Suisse. It is Deutsche Bank. It is Goldman Sachs. It's UBS. It's whomever who provided an over-the-counter call and put to Mr. Ackman. They did that for him, and then they went into the public markets and hedged some of their exposure because they probably figure Ackman's going to be right 9 times out of 10. We better cover because this guy's probably trading on pretty good information. So they're getting, if you will, a tip off that something's about to happen in that particular stock. So they're the footsteps that we see rather than Carl Icahn or Ackman themselves. We're seeing the footsteps of the people that provided them that over-the-counter option. And that's exactly the case here with Allergan. This is one of those plays that I think you guys should pay attention to and just save this screen shot of these stocks. This is not from today or yesterday, but this is on Option Monster, by the way. We have this button on there called Research Lab. And Research Lab runs from the first half hour of trading as soon as we have enough volume. It's not Heat Seeker, but it's showing us the groups and where the money's flowing, individual stocks and groups. So what I was filtering for this particular day was, these are all fracking plays. And those of you who actively trade these names are familiar with some of these. I cited one of these last week, EMES, Emerge Energy Services, the one on the top of that list. You can see that over the past quarter or 90 days, at this point in the year, again, this was not this week, those were the performance numbers for the quarter for Flotek, for U.S. Silica, for Carbo Ceramics, C&J Energy Services. These are all almost pure fracking plays. Now, they peaked probably in March of this year. We took advantage of the huge surge that these stocks were having because it was outrageous, folks. I encourage you, again, with a half an hour that I've got, I can't show you all of these moves, but look those up later. Then look at how much they've sold off as the price of energy has come down. And we all know that between Saudi dumping crude oil and so forth, many of these fracking plays have been hurt over the past 60 days to the point where many of them, I think, are great buys again. This EMES, by the way, was up around, if memory serves, it was over 130, traded all the way back down into the 70s, lost half the value from the March highs or something like that. But I encourage you to look at all these. And then what I'm going to be doing is getting back into these names over the next several weeks, because I believe energy is not a story that's over. I doubt if very many of you think it is. And no matter how many times Scott Wapner or anybody else tells me they're worried about crude going into and staying into the 60s, I'm not. I think that until we see a consumption drop, a very large consumption drop, this is just a problem of oversupply right now, not a problem of consumption or demand that has diminished dramatically. So I'll be getting back into many of these plays, and you'll probably hear me talking about many of these over the next several weeks, not because I'm talking my book and trying to drive the prices up, but because as we start to see institutional money going back in here, I think we'll probably get back into many of these names. And I would encourage you to familiarize yourself with them, because these will be great opportunities again. That pot opportunity for marijuana stocks, that was a very quick one. I think these are long-term plays and much more robust. So as Ben was nice enough to say, we encourage you folks to take advantage of this free offer that we've got. If you are somebody who's new to options or somebody who's even traded them for a few years, but you'd kind of like an assessment and sort of like a checkup, well, we can give you that for free. We've got a bunch of professional traders, floor traders from the SIBO and the Merck and the Board of Trade who work for us now. And they will give you a free one-on-one professional coaching, and it will be free. You won't have to give us your credit card or anything else. And they'll give you a $250 voucher towards the purchase, if you decide that's something that's suitable for you, for any of our packages. And all you have to do is write eSignal event in the essay box. So many folks, by the way, as I throw it back to Ben, because I'm going to try to stick to his time schedule pretty tightly, folks. People give us a hard time the number of times that our commercial runs for our book. And the funny thing is that we've done nearly 200,000 of those books now, and we truly do give them away. People only pay shipping and handling. And the success that the people that have bought the book have had has been gratifying, but also many of those people have then been exposed to the subscription services we offer, the coaching and education. And I'd encourage you guys to check that out, because the whole reason that Pete and I are continuing to do this is we think that an educated consumer is going to do much better in the market for a longer period of time. If that's with us and Trade Monster, fantastic. If you're somebody who's at another brokerage, we still wish you great good luck, and we appreciate your support. So with that, I'm going to throw it back to Ben. Ben, it's been a pleasure. I know the other coaches and speakers are raring to go, so I appreciate you letting me kick it off.
No problem. Thanks again, John, Dr. Jon Najarian. Folks, we're running a little short on time, and I want to queue up our next presenter, Darryl Guppy from ANSYS. So at this time, can I ask you please to, instead of opening up a huge session of questions, I'm going to ask that you send a question to eSignalProducts@interactivedata.com. Address it to me, Ben David, and whether or not the question is for John, Dr. Jon Najarian, and I'll be more than happy to route the questions off to him so that he can respond back to you in a timely manner. Again, please send an email to eSignalProducts@interactivedata.com. Attention, Ben David. Mention the question you have for John or any of the upcoming speakers, and I'll be more than happy to route them to you, to the right folks to answer the question. At this time, we're going to queue up the next presenter, which is Darryl Guppy from ANSYS. So as I load the presentation, I wanted to do a bit of a formal introduction of Darryl. So bear with me. On CNBC Asia and is known as the Chart Man. He is an equity and derivatives trader and author of books including Share Trading, Market Trading Tactics, Snapshot Trading, Better Stock Trading, Trend Trading, and the 36 Strategies of the Chinese for Financial Traders. Darryl is a contributor for financial magazines and media, including Technical Analysis of Stocks and Commodities magazine, a weekly column on CNBC Asia website, a weekly column in China Daily, Active Trader magazine, the Singapore and Malaysian Business Weekly, The Edge and Weekly on Stocks in Shanghai Security News in China, which is in Mandarin only. GuppyTraders.com, which is his website, is an international financial market education and training organization with offices in Darwin, Singapore, and Beijing. They provide independent education, training, analysis, and resources for retail and professional financial markets, market traders involved in stocks, CFDs, warrants, derivatives, futures, and commodities since 1996. During Darryl's presentation today, you will learn about his insights into trading successfully by identifying trends, which will explain his Guppy Multiple Moving Average, which stands for GMMA, which is a trading concept, and that he'll introduce the ANT Super Guppy Indicator Suite, which is an evolution of GMMA from ANSYS Limited, launched early this year on eSignal version 12, and much more. Again, in order to keep Darryl's presentation flowing, please hold off your questions to the end, and we'll get to them in a timely manner. With those final details aside, please welcome Darryl Guppy, and again, thank you for attending the Back in Black webinar. Darryl, off to you.
2011, the average holding period was 22 seconds. Goodness knows what it is today. It might be down to 1 or 2 seconds. This is partly a result of increases in high-frequency trading, a result in churning in the markets. What it really means for us is that there's an increase in volatility and an increase in the instability of trends. Let's see how that works to some extent, because this forms the foundation of the way that we have reconsidered and reapproached the market. In terms of ETFs, ETFs actually increase the volatility and they accelerate sector trend momentum. And the reason for this is relatively simple. Let's say that we are unfortunate enough in the current environment to own four gold mining stocks. That's our own personal portfolio. If one of those stocks, stock B, is performing badly, we simply sell it. It has no impact on our holdings in stocks A and C and D. But if we're coming in via an ETF, and retail traders are terrified of the market at the moment, so they're coming into the market increasingly through ETF trading rather than through direct trading. Once we get a little bit nervous about gold at the moment and we sell some of our position in an ETF, then the ETF has to sell down all of the stocks to preserve the weightings within the ETF. It's not just selling down the underperforming stock, B in this example. It's selling down A, C, and D, stocks that might be performing quite well. So what this suggests, what this impacts on, is the stability of trends and the rapidity of trend changes. So in this case, we might find that stock A is quite a well-established uptrend, but when it's hit by a wave of selling initiated by an ETF, it's sold down to exactly the same extent that stock B is sold down, that's already in a downtrend and underperforming. So what we're seeing is an increase in volatility, an acceleration in sector trend momentum, and the situation where time in the market now becomes a significant risk. The third impact is on liquidity. And what we're finding in the market structure before the global financial crisis, there were sectors of the market that had deep liquidity. There were sectors of the market that had shallow liquidity. But in between, it was more or less an even curve that went from deep to shallow. And there were many retail trading opportunities in the middle of that. And we were primarily equity traders. What we're finding now is that there is deep liquidity in a handful of stocks. And these are the stocks where exchange-traded funds are active, where high-frequency traders are active. Then the market rapidly trails off to shallow liquidity. Those stocks where there is reasonable liquidity are now very reduced. Our opportunities where there is deep liquidity are limited in terms of percentage returns. We have to use a derivative to boost those types of returns as much as possible. So this is the environment that we tried to develop some solutions for, these market structural changes. The solutions that we came up with, first of all, is range bar analysis. We want to understand the skeleton of market price. Now, this builds on some work that was done originally with point and figure work. I did that many years ago. I worked with Tom Doherty on this as well. So range bar analysis is an extension of point and figure work where we are focusing on the underlying price moves rather than the time span. It means that we cannot trust long-term trend behavior. It means we need to use tighter stops. But in using a tighter stop, we need to set a better stop so we're not being stopped out by false-acted signals. We're also looking at shorter-term trades. We want to use derivatives to boost the returns. And John was talking about using options. It's not our preferred approach. We have the advantage of using CFDs, which are not available in the United States, but are available in the rest of the world. And they commoditize futures trading to a very significant extent. We also move into futures markets and into FX markets. We simply avoid the small and middle-sized stocks. The opportunities that were there in the past are no longer available for us as traders. So what do we do with range bars? Range bars were originally developed by a Brazilian trader. Let's see how they really apply. We look at the top chart. The top chart is a time-based chart. Each candle, each bar, represents 1 minute. It's a standard chart we all see. For period one on the chart, then there's simply no action, no activity taking place within that period one. Each one is a one minute bar. Period two, there's a bit of a rally that takes place. It takes place rapidly over 6 or 7 minutes. Difficult to get hold of, difficult to log into in real time and trade effectively. What we want to do is we want to identify where momentum is developing and simply ignore this period where price is simply moving sideways. We want to filter out the unimportant price activity. So what we need to do is look at the size of price activity. I'm assuming that most people are familiar with the point and figure, where we set a box size and a reversal size. The box size gives us the sort of average volatility move that's taking place within our selected market. The reversal tells us how far price must move before we change from one column of X's for a rising price to zeros or O's for a falling price. If we look at a point and figure chart for exactly the same period as the bar chart, then we can see the period one is compressed. Yes, the point and figure chart achieves the objective of isolating the important information, the significant price moves. But in period two, where the price move develops, all we get is a column of X's. It's very difficult to trade into this movement. We need more detail. This is where range bars come in. Range bars here, period one, is still showing the same period of sideways movement. The range bar movement is predetermined. We get no signal within this region. We're simply watching what happens. But each bar may print over 1 minute or 2 minutes or 10 minutes or 5 minutes, depending on the range of price activity. But once price begins to break out in period two, we can see that we have much more detail. It's much more granular about the way the market is behaving. We're able to more quickly and rapidly identify where the breakout opportunity is developing, hop on board as quickly as possible, and trade that particular rally. So the first thing we've done, instead of using a time-based chart, we're using a range bar chart where the focus is on the way that price is moving, and we are filtering out the unimportant price activity. This has two major advantages. First, it helps to set much better stops. Now, better stop is a stop that is less frequently stopped out by accident. In other words, when the stop is hit, it's a genuine change in the trend. It's not a false signal. But what we also found is it makes the GMMA breakouts more accurate, because the GMMA, of course, is reading the averages of the range bars rather than the averages of a combination of price and time as we get on a standard type of chart. So what it means, particularly in terms of setting the stop loss, we apply what we call trader's ATR. Now, the ATR stop on a range bar chart is applied not to the price, but to the changes in the activity of price based on the range breakouts. The ATR becomes a derivative of a derivative, and this significantly improves reliability. Now, our display with traders ATR is different from the standard ATR display. What we do is we take the ATR value, in this case on a downtrend, and we project that above each of the range bars. What we're looking for confirmation of trend change is a close above the ATR value. If we're short on this environment, as soon as we get a close above the short side ATR, we cover our shorts. We then start to calculate the long side ATR, which is plotted, the ATR value, plotted below the range bars. When the ATR value on the long side crosses the ATR value on the short side, this becomes an entry signal. This in itself, we have used in the past purely as an entry and exit environment that is very successful in capturing the trends. When we apply this to a range bar chart, where we are concentrating purely on price activity and not the time element, we find that that improves the reliability considerably. Now, when we combine this with Super Guppy, we get a whole range of different advantages, because the Super Guppy is based on the range bar chart, not on the time elapsed chart. It's not on a daily chart or a 2 minute chart or a 3 minute chart. The time element is removed from the calculation. The focus becomes entirely on changes in price and price activity, not the time frame. So the result is that the GMMA signals become more accurate. And by improving the Super Guppy, by adding extra EMA calculations to it, it helps us to define the amplitude of the trend. The bubbles in the Super Guppy are more easily identified, and they are more reliably used to identify pullback and trend retracement opportunities. In other words, when we see the signal here, and I'm not too sure whether viewers can see my cursor moving at the crossover on the lower left-hand side, when we see the signal taking place here, there is a higher probability that this is an accurate signal and that this trend break is likely to continue. When we see the large separation on the right-hand side of the screen on the long-term averages in the Super Guppy, this increases the probability that this is a bubble, that we are going to get a genuine trend change. So once we get price moving back into the Super Guppy environment here on the long-term group of averages, then there is a higher probability that this is the end of the uptrend and the beginning of a new downtrend. It's a tradable environment. So the range bars set the environment. They change the way that we view the market. We're looking for the ants entry setup. We're looking for compression in the short and long-term GMA. That's the classic condition. We confirm that with a change in the range bar color, and we confirm the ants entry signal inside the entry channel. So this is how it works, and I'll take you through this step by step. We apply this to index trading, to E-minis, to commodities, to gold, to silver, to oil, and also to FX trading. And for FX trading, we're concentrating on those stocks, we're concentrating on those pairs with the highest 5-day average true range. So here's our entry setup. First of all, this is a fairly classic environment. We've got the Super Guppy in place. We're looking for compression between the long-term group and the short-term group. It's a classic condition. And in the middle of this chart display here in the setup one, we can see the crossover that's taken place. However, we need more information to determine whether this crossover here is genuine and whether we can take a long position on it with a high level of confidence. So here's our entry setup too. First of all, we've got that compression in that long-term and short-term group. We use a change in the range bar color to indicate that this is a suitable entry signal. It's like crossing the road. We stand on the edge of the edge of the sidewalk. We watch the light on the other side that says, yes, it's time to cross the road, but we don't step out. We check both left and right to make sure there's no other cars coming through the lights, that it is safe to cross. The change in the range bar colors tells us it is safe to take this signal, but it doesn't give us the exact entry point for that signal. That we need to go to entry setup three. Entry setup three, there are two factors. First of all, we set the upper entry range and the lower entry range. We need to make an entry within this entry range. Our signal is confirmed with the change in range bar colors shown purple here. What we are then waiting for is for the ants signals to fire. Now, the ants signals are, in this case, the red triangles. They are like ants crawling over the chart, which is one of the reasons why we call it the ants system. So what we're looking for is an ants entry signal that occurs inside the entry channel. It occurs between the upper entry range and the lower entry range. Obviously, in this case, we're trading short, which is why the ant signals are red rather than green. And we're trying to get the maximum height of entry so that we can get the maximum return coming from this particular trade. We have a range of four entry signals here that are all taking place within the entry channel. They all are following the purple range bars, which are telling us this is the safe time to enter. We can enter with a high level of probability of success. So, what we're looking for, we're waiting for the breakout to develop. It's important we don't chase the breakout. First we wait. When the breakout develops, we wait for the retreat and rebound to develop before we enter the trade. We're looking for an entry point that is inside the entry zone. The best is at the edge of the Super Guppy, and the first stop loss is on the edge of the entry zone. Let me just go back just for one moment. Because when we're looking at this chart here, remember, this is a range bar chart. This is not 1 minute or 2 minute or 3 minute price bars. They are range bars. So as the activity of trading increases, as the volatility of trading increases, then a new range bar is painted on the chart. So simply by waiting here, this doesn't mean we've waited 15 or 20 minutes before we get our entry signal. These range bars may paint within 2 or 3 seconds or 2 or 3 minutes. depending on depending on which particular market you're trading. So the number of bars doesn't tell us the elapsed time. The number of bars tell us the changes in price behavior, and that can occur very rapidly. So these entry signals may occur within 5 or 6 minutes rather than within 10 or 20 or 30 minutes if each one represented a one-minute chart. In terms of FX tactics, a large daily price range provides a consistent opportunity of trading. We take the five-day average range of price. There is an 85% probability that a price move will reach 75% of its trading range. Understanding these range relationships is the foundation of the ANSFX trading approach. Now, preference is for tactical trading. I'm not trying to take a position in dollar yen that's going to extend for 3 or 4 weeks. What I'm looking for is a 30 to 60 pips a trade, up to 160, maybe 200 pips a trade. The objective is to get the entry and exit consistently right, and then using size to generate the profit, not the number of trades. And for this, FX markets give us the sort of depths that we require to be able to trade effectively. So we're looking for a large daily price range. We calculate 75% of that trading range projected downwards and upwards from the current price, and there's an 85% probability of reaching that trading range. That sets our initial downside target. We use the ATR, the trader's ATR, as the stop loss. The target, 75% value of the five-day average true range, 85% probability of being achieved. This becomes a statistical trade, a high probability trade that gives us particular advantages in these sorts of markets. So here's how it works. Here's how we manage an ANS trade quite typically. First of all, on the upper side, you can see the trading range bands. We can see the change in color, the purple range bars that change here that tell us this trend change is confirmed, and it confirms the crossover of the long-term super guppy. Our entry point is on either one of those first two ANT fires, or you can enter on the third one if you wish, but our preference is to enter on the first one or two ANT entry signals. The stop loss is calculated using the trader's ATR. This is the red line through here. Now, as this trade develops, we're going short, the trade remains open until there is a range bar that closes above the value of the ATR. If we have an ANS entry signal when the price is outside of the entry channel, as in here for instance, we don't trade. Price must be inside the entry, inside the trading channel, then we enter the stock. If it's outside, the signal is ignored. So on this particular screen here, and this is a trade we took recently, our entry is signal on the first one or two ANTs. We enter here and we use the ATR as the stop loss as the trade develops. Then we calculate the target, which is 75% of the five-day average true range. Here's our target level through here. Now, this gives us two methods that we can manage this trade. First, we can simply take an exit at the first range bar that moves below the 75% target calculation, and we will lock in this period of move from here, from our first entry point, first ANT signal, down to this exit point where we have a range bar closing below the 75% calculated target. Not everyone is comfortable with that. We use this as a minimum target. Once that target's achieved, then we continue, if the trade's going to continue to moving, we continue to use the ATR as the stop loss. We don't exit the trade until there is a price bar that moves above the value of the ATR on a short side trade. In this particular instance, we would have been much better taking our 75% target exit because our exit on the ATR is slightly less effective. But in a long-term trade, we will find once our 75% target has been reached that the ATR may give some additional value, some additional length of time in the trade. Here's some examples with gold. And we use three screens. Our first screen, top left-hand corner, number 3, provides the direction of the trade. Are we long? Are we short? It's fairly simple. But we're looking at GMMA relationships, and we're looking at the trading signals. These charts have been extended to the right-hand side, so I can show you how each of these trades has developed. There's the trading signal that we're looking for on the left-hand chart, number 3. Chart number 2 gives us the confirmation that these signals are correct. This is where we're getting the color changes taking place in the range bars. Chart number 1, the lower chart, is the actual trading signals. So here, we're trading 75% range. Our entry range is on that first shaded blue area. Our trade takes down to the 75% level. We're out of the trade. We get another range signal taking place in the middle range here. We trade on a shorter term trade, not quite as good a value. We get our exit signals back in this range here. Again, the third signal gives us a slightly longer trade. So we've got 3 intraday trades based on this longer term downtrend. We're picking up the subtrends within the broader range. Is that what you want to do? For us, for gold, for silver, for commodities, for trading E-minis and trading FX pairs, this gives us good, steady, consistent returns, and that's what we're looking for, consistency. I'm not going here necessarily for the big hits. I want just consistent, stable returns from a market where time in the market becomes a significant risk. If you look at oil, another example here, the same type of situation. 3 provides the direction. We can see that this rally on the left-hand side has retreated. We get the signal here that tells us that, yes, this is a significant change in the trend. We're moving on the downside. Number 2 gives us the confirmation of the signals. We're looking at these on the screen here. And then number 1 screen gives us the exact entry. Our entry point is here, and this is an extended trade. Again, we can manage with an ATR. It's not shown on this particular screen. Or we can shoot for the 75% trend range, which is what we've done. So the components that we're looking for in terms of the ANCH system, first of all, is range bars. Range bars are capturing the underlying price moves that are significant. It acts as a filter. It filters out the unimportant price moves. This, by the way, is automated so that we can get an alert signal when the appropriate crossovers take place. Then we apply a super guppy. Now, by applying the guppy model for moving average analysis on the top of a range bar chart, we are getting more reliable crossover signals, more reliable signals that are telling us and identifying the trend changes that are taking place. We're eliminating the bulk of the false signals. It tells us, yes, we should be here. This is the time to start moving. Then we apply the ATR, again, based on the range bar chart. So the ATR calculation is using the price components of the range bar chart, not the time-based chart. And this is particularly significant. It makes the stop loss set with an ATR much more accurate. We have less false signals. It makes it much more sensitive to changes in the significant price activity. This is a key factor. One of the problems when you apply an ATR on a normal chart where each bar is related to time, you get so much noise. It's so difficult to decide which is significant and which is not significant. This decision is made on the underlying price display on the range bars, not by adjusting the values of the ATR. Range bars, super guppy, and then range-based ATR. Combine this with the ANCH system, and it develops, it's a conceptual breakthrough. The use of the ANCH entry and exit signals provides a practical application of the concept of capturing reliably these changes in volatility that are taking place. So here are the advantages. This is what has taken our trading back into the black this year, consistently. First, advantage 1, the GMA is calculated on the closing price of the range bar. Advantage 2, the super guppy components are calculated using the range bar. So the GMMA is the basic calculation. The super guppy, the additional bits that are added to the original GMMA, are also calculated using the range bar. The advantage 3, the proprietary ANCH indicator algorithm provides a reliable entry and exit signal based on these trend changes. we have a change in the color of the range bars that alert us that the developing entry situation is under development. You will get an alert signal that says, look at this chart. You need to be looking in this place right now and waiting for the proprietary ANTS indicator algorithm to provide the first of the entry signals. If it falls within the entry channel, then we can take it, and we can take it with a high level of confidence. The advantage four is that the adjusted ATR, the trader's ATR that is displayed on the price bar chart, on the range bar chart, gives us a way to set a proper stop loss that is directly related to the significant volatility of price behavior. It removes time calculation from the time calculation element. It removes time from the calculation and allows us to focus purely on the volatility and the changes in price. We are looking purely at price action. And that provides tremendous advantages in reliability of each of those signals. It allows us to take those trades with a much, much higher level of confidence. Now, I'm happy to go back and look at some of this in more detail as required, but at this point in time, I'm also happy to take as many questions. Back to you.
So, folks, it's been Dave from eSignal. Please go ahead and type in your questions in the chat box, and I'll moderate for Darryl as you send them in. I'm going to quickly scan Darryl and see if there's any questions now, and it looks like...
Okay, we've got some of our ANTS staff who have been answering questions on the side as I've been talking, like how do we determine the range bar size, etc. But I'm still happy to take questions. I finished a little early to keep us on the schedule and also to allow time for questions as well.
So, Charles, you asked what is Darryl Guppy's website. So we have Darryl Guppy's website, which is www.guppytraders.com. Also, his products are available through a partnership with ANSYS, and that email address is www.ansys.com. I'm going to go ahead and type those in the chat box as well for everyone so they can see, review, and connect with Darryl and ANSYS team to discuss the products that they're offering through ANSYS.com. Okay? Any other questions? It looks like... Okay, and it looks like ANSYS, you're responding to some of the questions as well.
Yes, that's correct. Yes, so we've got multiple people answering the questions in this sense. But look, let me just talk a little bit. What's the key problem with our markets at the moment? The problem is volatility, which is an advantage, but also a disadvantage. The other problem is trend instability. Trends are collapsing much more rapidly than they should. In the past, what we've seen is a relatively slow end of trends. A rapid collapse in trend was unusual. A slow collapse in trend gave us plenty of time to set the stops, to adjust the stops, to protect our profits, and to move on. But when we get these rapid changes that are taking place, it's much more difficult to manage our risk. Where do we set our stop loss? Do we set it much, much lower than we should and end up taking a much larger loss or erosion of profits than we should just to take into account these volatility spikes? Particularly as high-frequency traders go and gun the stops, what's our solution? Our solution is to set a better stop. And to set a better stop, we need a better technique. If we continue to use traditional time-based bar charts, then we have a combination focus on both time and price movement. What's really important? The time is not important. It's the price movements that's important. Now, in the old days, back when I was doing charts by hand, we used point and figure. Point and figure eliminated the time and allowed us to focus purely on the price activity, what was important. And by setting the box and reversal size, we made a decision about what constituted an important price move for that particular stock and what was insignificant price action. But it's a pretty blunt tool. It's trying to smash the market open with a sledgehammer. We need something with more sophistication in today's market. The range bar allows us to achieve the same thing. We decide in advance what constitutes significant or insignificant price activity within the market, within the stock or the index or the commodity that we're following. We set that. So our underlying display focuses on the price movement, on the significance of price movement, irrespective of the time. And that then has flow-through advantages to a whole range of other indicator applications, and it improves the reliability. This is the key. This is the key. I'm not in a situation where I'm getting false exit signals through volatility spikes that are unimportant. I know which volatility spikes to ignore and which ones I need to take notice of. The other biggest change that we've found in the markets is that time in the market becomes a major risk factor. The longer in the market, the longer in the trend, the higher the probability that trend will collapse, and collapse rapidly. Now, unless we're on the ball, we're going to surrender an awful amount of our profits. I don't want to do that. So by reducing the time frame, by moving to FX markets where I've got deep and consistent liquidity, I can trade with a high level of reliability. I can improve my results by increasing my size, not by increasing the number of trades. So if I'm using an ANTS trading system, I'm getting more reliable signals, maybe not as many as I would like, but I'm getting more reliable signals so that when I take it, I have the confidence to be able to trade the size. I have to be able to trade less often, but generate the sorts of returns that I'm looking for out of the market. These are the key advantages that we find. How does ANTS handle volatile situations? Because, and this is just a question from Michelle that's came up, it handles volatile situations because it's focused on the price movement, not on the time that the price movement takes place. So that gives us an advantage. It allows us to lock into that volatility and to generate a profit from those moves. Because when you've got a volatile move, what time frame should we measure in? Should we measure in 5-second blocks, 10-second blocks, 1-minute blocks, 3-minute blocks, 4-minute blocks? We have to make an a priori decision about what's appropriate for that volatility. And that decision might be wrong, a priori, before the fact. But by working with a range chart, the decision is already made as to which price activity is significant and which isn't. As the volatility develops, it allows us to identify it rapidly and to trade it appropriately, because as the volatility is there, the chart is painted with more bars simply because there's more momentum activity. Whereas if you're using a time-based chart, the chart is not painted with more bars because we're only looking at time elapsed, not at what the price is doing. More questions?
So, Darryl, at this time, can you give me back control of the page? I'm going to go ahead and share ANTS's special offer for Black and Black. No problem.
I've stopped sharing.
So, folks, I'm going to re-enter the slides I shared with you. One slide I did not get to mention was ANTS's special offer. With ANTS, if you get the indicator suite, you get a 30-day free test drive of the ANTS Super Guppy indicator suite. I just provided the link in the chat box window. You also included with part of that purchase, you get Darryl Guppy's white paper, which is GMMA Explained. You get registration on the ANTS user forum. You get a 3-month unlimited email technical support opportunity, an invitation to the ANTS Skype trading room hosted by a team of seasoned traders, and you get a copy of the 3-2-1 ANTS trading strategy for Forex. So again, I wanted to quickly point out the URL for where the ANTS indicator is located on the eSignal website. You know, and I wanted you to partake of this special offer for Back and Black attendees who are attending. Let's save some room for a couple more questions before we queue up our next presenter, Howard Lindzon from StockTwit. So it looks like ANTS is coming. So Richard, it looks like you said have to go. Okay, sorry. Is it available for TOS? It looks like RM sent that question. And I'm not sure if Anthony will be responding to that. Oh, think or swim. Okay. No, it is not, I believe. Correct,
that's correct,
Darryl?
At this point in time. Okay, so someone asked whether it's like deconstructing a candle chart or a candle. It is to some extent, and it's a different way of thinking about the behavior in the market. Now, point and figure, Tom Dorsey is world expert on point and figure. I worked with Tom Dorsey on and off for the last 10 or 15 years. Point and figure was a powerful solution to understanding price activity without the need to understand time activity. We are accustomed to thinking of a combination of time and price. That's the way we typically think about the market. If we remove the time factor, then it allows us to concentrate purely on what price activity is doing. Now, I came to point and figure charting when I first started trading because I was working in a very isolated situation in the middle of the outback of Australia. I did not have access to daily news or to daily charts, so I had to construct charts by hand, and they were of necessity, lagged in time. So my solution then was to eliminate the time, and point and figure allowed me to do that. Point and figure was originally developed on the trading floor. You'd see all the traders using point and figure charts. What were they focused on? They weren't worried about time. They were worried about what the price was doing. They were trying to extract the significant price moves from those who were unimportant. They were trying to eliminate the noise in the market. And then if we go back historically, we had Metastock and others that came into the market that made time and price charting very easy to do. You just simply pressed a button. There was a time and chart price display. And we've become accustomed to seeing the standard time and price chart display. Throw that out the window. Come back and look at it in terms of just what the price activity is doing. It gives you a different understanding of volatility, no longer related to time, related purely to the price movement. And this different understanding of the market gives us a more sophisticated application than point and figure is capable of. Point and figure was basically limited to box size and reversal size. Pretty rough system. One box, one reversal, can't use that. One box size, two reversal, yeah, that's worthwhile. Maybe three box, four reversal, all sorts of combinations. It didn't have a consistency. You had to make a decision basically for each individual chart. But with the range bar, we have a consistent application across a whole range of instruments, and it makes a difference in terms of reliability and the way that we conceptualize the market and what's important, the way it eliminates the noise. Can we apply it with options? We haven't done that at this point in time. Volume is not used inside of ants. The volume is less important. We are automatically in an FX market trading where we have deep liquidity. If we're trading E-minis, we have deep liquidity. If we're trading commodities, trading gold, trading silver, trading oil, we have the requisite liquidity. We're not worried about low volume. It's simply not there.
Okay, folks. I'm also going to, just because we're running out of time and we need to queue up our next presenter, please send an email to eSignalProducts@interactivedata.com. I'll route your questions accordingly to each presenter for any question we didn't get a time to get through for this webinar. Thank you, Darryl. I appreciate your time here. And at this point, I'm going to go queue up our next presenter. So at this time, I wanted to formally introduce Howard Lindzon of StockTwits. Howard is the chairman of the board and co-founder of StockTwits, a social network for traders and investors to share real-time ideas and information. It was recently named one of the top 10 most innovative companies in web by Fast Company and one of the 50 best websites by Time Magazine. Mr. Lindzon has more than 20 years experience in the financial community, acting in both an entrepreneurial and investing capacity. With a unique vision for starting and successfully managing innovative companies, he is the managing partner of Social Leverage, a holding company that invests in early stage web businesses. Howard continues to manage a hedge fund he started in 1998. He created WallStrip and more than 400 original web video shows, which was purchased by CBS Corp in 2007. He is an active angel with many success angel investments, including Rent.com, which was purchased by eBay in 2005 for $415 million, GolfNow.com, which was purchased by Comcast in June 2008, and LifeLock, which includes lead investors such as Bessemer Venture Partners and Kleiner Perkins Caulfield and Byers. Mr. Lindzon's new media and internet business investments also include Lemos.com, BlogTalkRadio.com, Buddy Media, which was purchased by Salesforce.com in August 2012, Ticketfly, AssistFly, which was purchased by Salesforce.com in September 2011, Bit.ly, and TweetDeck, which was purchased by Twitter in June 2011. Mr. Lindzon received an MBA at Arizona State University and an MIM from the American Graduate School of International Management. In order to keep Howard's presentation flowing smoothly, I ask that you please hold your questions till the end of the presentation. However, please go ahead and send your questions through the chat box, and Howard or I will respond in due time. With those final details aside, let's go ahead and have Howard present his portion of the presentation. Howard, off to you. So I'm going to go on mute real quick. Hi folks, it's Ben David. We're waiting for Howard to join us in a bit, so stay tuned. Hi folks, it's Ben Dave from eSignal. Again, we're trying to get a hold of Howard. I believe he's on. He's just having some technical difficulties at this time. So we'll be starting momentarily. Please stay tuned. In the meantime, as we queue up Howard, I kind of wanted to again reiterate some of the special offers that eSignal is offering right now. Our special offers page is www.esignal.com/specials. Including some of those highlighted specials right now, get eSignal Premier for only $99 a month, which is one-third off the retail price. We also have a fall special, get eSignal 3 months free. Yes, folks, this webinar is being recorded. We will be sending everyone a copy of this webinar and a follow-up email. Let me check on Howard, team. In the meantime, I'm going to go back. Hi folks, this has been Dave from eSignal. We're still troubleshooting Howard's audio issue at this time. I'm working with him and his team right now to get it all resolved, so he'll be joining us momentarily. Thank you and I appreciate your patience. Hi, folks. Ben Dave from eSignal. My apologies. We're still trying to connect with Howard via audio. We're trying to set this up as soon as possible, so please stay tuned. Hi folks, it's Ben Dave from eSignal. We're still trying to troubleshoot Howard's audio issue, and we hope to have him on momentarily. Again, thank you for your patience. We'll be on soon. Folks, I have an idea. As we think about how we can get Howard back on, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen so you can see the stock Twits interface that I have. So hold on for a second. Let me see if I can open up a web browser through this functionality and share you my Can everyone see my Stock Twits page right now, which is an eSignal channel? Perfect. So as you can see, it's a pretty simple interface, and it works just like Twitter. You tag anyone who's on eSignal, and hopefully they also have the same Twitter handles, and you can go ahead and type in something as simple as, "Hi, everyone. Hope everyone is enjoying eSignal Black and Black. What's your great trading idea? Enter for a chance to win an iPad mini." So again, folks, with this contest that we have here, we if you go on social media, that will be Twitter, StockTwits, Facebook, Google+, LinkedIn. If you provide your great trading idea and investment idea, and if you hashtag eSignalBIB, short for Back in Black, you will be random. One person will be randomly chosen to be given an iPad mini. So again, send your great trade ideas, hashtag eSignalBIB. We'll review them. Eventually, next week, we'll be presenting one award winner. We'll be contacting you directly to say congratulations for not only registering but attending eSignal's Back in Black event, and we'll be offering you and shipping out an iPad mini to you. Does anyone have any questions regarding the StockTwits interface while I'm here? Just kind of wanted to show you what you could see. You could obviously see a heat map, which has some trending stocks. So right now, for example, technology, if you mouse over it, I'm seeing some different trends for different stocks. They're grouped into utilities, financial, consumer goods, and right now, in the last 24 hours, technology takes the brunt of the heat map index. So again, go to StockTwits.com if you don't have an account. Register for your free account and start joining the social media craze that is StockTwits.com. Hopefully create a handle that works directly with your Twitter account. You could share your messages on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn. You could mark the stock as either bearish or bullish. And you could post images and YouTube videos here as well. Oh, it looks like we have Howard that's ready to share his screen. I would be more than happy to let you control it. Howard, can we hear you? Hi, folks. Again, regarding the contest for the iPad mini, go to your social media channel, again, whether that's Twitter, StockTwits, LinkedIn, Google+.
Hello?
Provide a comment on your best trade. Oh, Howard, we have you.
Hey, everybody. I have I am 49 years old and just a dummy. So, hopefully.
So, Howard, do you want to go ahead and share your documents, your presentation material?
No way, I'm winging it now. Let's share my screen. Wow, Adobe is... You know what, I'm just going to chat a little bit about trends in the social boom, okay? Let me keep it really simple for everybody. So first, Ben, let me know if you can hear me still. And then you
can... We can hear you loud and clear.
All right, everybody, I'm in London. I had to go through Iceland last night. And I don't know if my laptop got dropped, but it was working a little while ago, so I apologize. Thanks, eSignal. Ben, good job holding everything together there. Let me action pack this 20 minutes that I have remaining and talk about the social boom. In 2006, this boom started with YouTube. And then we had obviously Facebook and Twitter, and now we have the verticalization of all these networks with companies like Reddit and hopefully StockTwits. Today, StockTwits is thriving, 100,000 daily active people, over 500,000 people have signed up and contributed ideas. And Ben gave you a pretty good screenshot of how simple it is to share. One thing I think is super important is journaling. All the great traders have journaled. And in 2007, when I started using Twitter, I was inspired by the 140 characters. And thought that as silly as it would be to share what I'm eating or where I am, that people would want to share ideas around tickers. And that was the inspiration for, and I will share the presentation later, everybody. But let's keep it simple, right? We had a great detailed presentation before. I like to think of things in much bigger ideas and much longer term trends. And so with StockTwits and now eSignal incorporating StockTwits, people from around the world in real time can share their thoughts and ideas and get feedback in incredible speed. There's thousands of great traders. We have full-time staff, Stefan, Sean, myself, because we love trading ourselves on the streams all day. So my idea of creating StockTwits was a place to journal. In 2015, we've been working all year 2014 on this. 2015, it will become apparent why you've been sharing all these years socially, especially on StockTwits when we launch Elasticsearch. We'll be able to retrieve all your ideas that you've shared over the years. And if you're just starting today, ShareAway will be able to pull up all your ideas. So if you want to search Howard Nike or Howard Apple, and pull up all the times that I've just mentioned that ticker, you'll be allowed to. My inspiration for trend following is really more out of how poorly I was as a short-term trader. And as I've gotten older and tried everything, I'm much more comfortable as a trend follower. To me, there's four key things to trend. The first being price. Price to me is the ultimate indicator. There's a lot of talk around the web with respect to big data. I think of price as small data. It's accumulation of all these data points that now in real time we can get free price. But at the same time, I look at price as small data. Everybody has the same piece of data. We're all looking at the same thing. And so price is still the most significant part of a trend following system for entries and for exits. Volume, the second, if the X and Y axis, volume has always been a great indicator. I think since 2008, since technology has moved a lot of volume off network into dark pools, into options, into global markets and ETFs, volume has not been as great an indicator in many of the markets as volume has moved off market. And of course, during the same time where volume around stocks has not been as reliable an indicator, this social dimension, the social boom that I talked about earlier, the social dimension of who said what has become super important. Meaning, Carl Icahn, for example, a master at using social media, he is now gone to the broadcast platform of Twitter. And at StockTwits, we when we're following, or anybody in the world following him, quickly shares his ideas. So instead of having a book time on CNBC or talk to the Journal or Bloomberg about his ideas, he can post them on Twitter. And now so many tens of thousands of people are following him that he can move markets in 140 characters. And that's the beauty, right? It's, you know, up until 2007, 2008, broadcast was controlled by Bloomberg, Reuters, even let's say CNBC. But since 2007, 2008, we're seeing a lot now with Ackman and the Herbalife battle with Icahn, this who, this third dimension of what I call this social volume dimension, who, what, when, where, why, and how, and ability to track these people has become the ultimate third dimension. So armed with price, volume, and who, which is StockTwits, and also Twitter, which is another one I use, we really can dumb down systems and really hone in on my favorite ideas. For me, with price, I like to look at 3-year highs, if not 5-year and all-time highs. So for me, it doesn't even get interesting, doesn't even get put on a list for me until a stock is, you know, hitting 3 or 5 year highs. Preferably, I like to see all-time highs. The old saying, especially around relative strengths, stocks that are doing well generally continue to do well. So price, to me, still remains the ultimate indicator. And I say that because I do all my list checking. I've throttled everything back to just give myself 3-5 year all-time highs. So that's my initial tool. You know, I don't use any special Bloomberg. I don't use anything but StockTwits and Twitter for news to manage, you know, well over $100 million and have obviously hundreds of millions of dollars in people's money following stuff that's going on the stream. So price gives me that initial list. Then the most important thing to me is investing in things that I know. So from that list of all-time highs or 5-year highs, you know, I like to find companies that I'm immersed in the catalysts of. So one easy one for me has been Nike. You know, for the last 3 or 4 years, the stock has been consistently making all-time highs. You know, there's periods of digestion, but for me, Nike is one of those companies that I'm immersed in. I have 2 kids. They live in Nike and Under Armour. I travel the world. Today I got off a plane, all I notice are people's shoes, Nike running shoes for travel. And so for me, the catalysts have been around Nike have been both obviously the global brand. Technology has come into becoming a huge leverage tool for Nike. The cost of their materials continue to drop. The product gets lighter and lighter, more personalized, easier to ship, cost of shipping going down, oil prices dropping right now. continued catalyst for this global brand. So again, price, that's where I start. That's where I get my curated ideas. And I don't really like to follow more than 30 to 50 ideas at a time. Also, for context, I like to really keep track of how many stocks are making all-time highs. And really, if you're a beginner, it's going to take 3 to 6 months to get a feel for how many stocks are making all-time highs in context. So if hundreds of stocks continue to make five-year, three-year all-time highs, you're in a good market, a target-rich market, and therefore, it's time to put money to work. From there, number two for me are companies that I understand, the catalyst. You know, one of the biggest trends I've ever missed is in biotech, but because I don't understand the businesses themselves, and it's hard for me to get my head around, you know, how they're valued in the binary outcomes of FDA reports and the drugs being passed on from stage to stage. I've avoided that. And, you know, to be a great investor, sometimes you just have to miss some of these trends. You can't catch all of them. So the key for me, again, price, the catalyst, and then a combination of the volume, who is chattering, and when they're chattering, and then generally that the consistency of that person. You know, it's easy on StockTwits for me to go and see how often the style of the contributions from any one one person. So I'm going to open it to questions. It's easy to find me on the StockTwits stream. It's easy to find me pretty much 24/7 on the streams. If you at Howard Lindzon, you will find it. You will find me, and I'm pretty good within 24 hours of getting people back that use our product. To give you some ideas that are working right now, software continues to work. Workday, one of the great companies of the next era, human resource CRM software. We're seeing it with Zendesk as well, Z-E-N. Workday is W-D-A-Y, and Zendesk is Z-E-N. I don't own those stocks right now, but I've been following them a real long time. And if the market stays strong here, those are two that are on my watch list. Another stock showing up really well, although I don't own it, is Salesforce. You know, a lot of people talk about how, you know, price to earnings, price to sales are, you know, way too high. But again, the stock continues to show strength. And what they've done is locked down the future of enterprise software and CRM. So I see a lot of strength there. Obviously, the biotech sector continues to be strong. And then retail and apparel like Nike, Under Armour, and some of these retail stocks continue to be strong. Stefan's on the stream right now. He's always here to help you find great people. And I really do apologize about the audio difficulties at the beginning of this, which kind of threw us all off here at the beginning of the webinar, but it's really a 24/7 support desk. And now with eSignal integration, if you're using eSignal, it's just a great interface to be able to go in and share ideas into StockTwits, get feedback back, whip back and forth. I really get, like I said, the who said what about those stocks. Really find some people that you can lock in with in a group and attack the markets. So Ben, why don't you see if there's any questions for me? I like to keep things really simple. I don't really dive that much deeper into markets than what I've really talked to you about. I like to keep my list small, and I like to keep my positions, you know, under 10 to 15, even in a bull market. So fire away with any questions. Ben, thanks for your patience here.
Sure, no problem, Howard. So I think, I'm not sure, Howard, if you responded to Pavel's question where you mentioned four dimensions: price, volume, social dimensions. What is the fourth?
Sorry. Price and volume have been the two dimensions, Ben. And with the advent in 2007 with Facebook and Twitter, we had this 24/7 global customer support, this global social dimension. And what StockTwits has done with the dollar sign and with, you know, a curated platform to talk in short form around stocks, we've added that third dimension for stocks. So the third dimension is social. There was always the price and volume. In 2008, really volume after the crisis, volume has moved off the exchanges. You know, if you go look at the New York Stock Exchange, if you're ever watching CNBC or get a picture of it, it's empty. You know, everything got distributed. And so what StockTwits does is bring everybody back together. And with eSignal plugging into our API and so many other companies like Fidelity and the brokers plugging into our API, we're re-establishing this hub, this group of hundreds of thousands of traders that in real time are talking about the market. So this social dimension, it's really just three dimensions. And to be honest, I can live off, if I were to give up one of those dimensions, it would just be general volume, you know, exchange volume. I would live off price and StockTwits, the social volume. And that's pretty much 90% of what I do. Does that help answer your question?
I hope so, Paul. Well, please respond if that answers your question. The next question I see from Bree is, how do you read your heat map? So folks on the screen, I'm obviously sharing my screen, and you can see the social signals heat map. Howard, can you speak a little bit more about how can users read the heat map on StockTwits?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're a little biased towards technology just because, you know, it's a technology platform. So I think for the last 5 years, and you know what, maybe just, you know, the stream has been correct. You know, a lot of people like to fade the stream, and I'm like, you know, the StockTwits stream, about 80% of messages, we don't share this data publicly, but about 80% of the messages since about 2009 have been bullish, you know, if they could be tagged one way or the other. And that's with all kinds of algorithms to filter out spam, etc. So the streams have been pretty bullish. They've leaned technology and healthcare for the last 3 to 4 years. So what you do is you open up the heat map, you can kind of see where the action is. I prefer personally to use the trending tickers, you know, on my iPhone app or my people who have a Droid app. I really just at the top of the website, or if I open the, you know, I really get to see a curated list of, it's right underneath the logo, right under the search bar, you have the 10 to 12 trending tickers. That really gives me a feel for what's happening in the market. We're really going to spend a lot of time on mobile and are about 30 days away from our iOS launch, really giving people a tighter look of why things are trending in the original. So you don't have to dive in too deep. But really, we give you a great feel of what 100,000 daily active people are talking about. And we remove penny stocks. So stocks under $5 cannot trend on StockTwits. Maybe one day we'll add small caps. But because I don't trade small caps, I can't, kind of in the vision of myself, who started the company, we've avoided small cap stocks and a lot of the spam and aggravation that goes along with that. You know, I've always felt that along with IBD, the Investors Business Daily, that, you know, stocks over $10 to $15 are the ones that I generally own. 80 to 90% of the stocks I own are over $15. Occasionally I'll buy a $10 to $15 stock, but, you know, we generally curate it down to that stock, those type of stocks. So anything that you see on our trending ticker is where the focus is right now. And no, Richard, penny stocks to me are, you know, under $2. But one of our rules of trending tickers is stocks over $5. so, for example, Plug, PLUG, has been trending for over a year in terms of amount of messages. but really didn't start showing up on the trending bar until it hit over $5. Ben, other questions?
Folks, this is a good opportunity for you to send in any final questions to Howard. And again, we're trying to stay on schedule, so if we can't get to your question, please shoot an email to esignalproducts@interactivedata.com. Send it to a subject line, put attention Ben David, and I will route your direct questions to the appropriate presenter and respond back to you through that email or through a follow-up email separately, okay? Again, that email is
esignalproducts@interactivedata.com. Yeah, sure. Ben, the one main question is, you know, for people using Twitter, why their messages from Twitter don't show up on StockTwits. And that's more an indication of these social wars going on. StockTwits has always had a pretty open API, and as Twitter has grown, and they've done this to LinkedIn and Instagram, and vice versa, Twitter made it very difficult under the way we would have to display their messages to pull in their messages. So there's lots of easy ways, including eSignal, to post messages from StockTwits into Twitter, but we no longer pull in messages from Twitter, and that's mainly because of the terms of use of Twitter. So there's, you know, you can pop out a stream. Stefan will show you. I unfortunately can't show you a demo, everything linked, but you can just pop out a message box either in Chrome or just from the website and just use StockTwits as a message platform. People are asking still about the heat map, and I apologize for not giving a concise answer because I really use the trending bar and not the heat map. The heat map breaks it down by sections, and what I find is that, Ben, if you pull up the actual heat map there, the tab above stocks there, we break it down by where, you know, we've broken down the stocks into different sectors. And, you know, for the last 3 to 5 years, it's been healthcare and technology, just to the left there of your arrow, that have been leading. Dan, the reason I use Twitter so often is because I cover a lot more than just stocks. I like to talk about news and goof around, and StockTwits isn't where I want to do that, and that's generally on Twitter. And also, Dan, I invest in startup companies in a lot of the technology industry. The people that don't trade stocks that invest in startups, and a lot of the founders use Twitter. And so from a brand building perspective, that's why I use Twitter. But all my stock ideas I share on StockTwits. So I would say about 50% of all my stock ideas are on Twitter. 100% are on StockTwits.
Okay, folks. Thank you, Howard, for your time. I'm going to go ahead and queue up our next presenter, which is Ron Wheeler from Dynamic Trend. So as I load up his presentation materials, I wanted to briefly introduce Ron. More than 17 years of experience as a trading educator since beginning his career with Tom Joseph, the creator of Advanced Get. He has worked with thousands of traders across the globe, ranging from beginners to seasoned veterans, on various topics from building new trading plans to complex risk modeling, as well as countless time live trading demonstrations. He specializes in all aspects of trading, from short-term day trading to long-term position trading on a wide range of markets such as futures, forex, and options, utilizing both Elliott Wave analysis and GAN theory. He currently focuses on equity option trading, utilizing various strategies such as iron condors, butterflies, and vertical credit spreads. He currently serves as Director of Education for Dynamic Trend Incorporated, which is the creator of the Options Analytics suite of tools, and serves as a mentor for eSignal's Advanced Get and Option Analytics software. During Ron's presentation today, you will learn about how to showcase eSignal. He will showcase eSignal's two flagship add-ons, which is Advanced Get and Options Analytics. This demonstration will start at finding predictable market patterns based on Elliott Wave models using Advanced Get, and transform those into profitable and accurate options credit spreads. He'll show you how to use the eSignal Advanced Get Scanner to find quick trade scenarios, how to scan trades in Options Analytics for options suitable for credit spreads, how to use Options Analytics Spread Select tool to build spread candidates, and with the patent-pending OA projection tool, accurately model trade to expiration, including profits, volatility, and delta position. Again, in order to keep Ron's presentation flowing well, I ask that you please hold your questions till the end of the presentation. Please go ahead and send your questions through the chat box, and Ron or I will respond in due time. At this time, I wanted to formally hand it off to Ron. Ron, off to
you. Good afternoon, everybody, or good morning, I should say. This is Ron Wheeler. The first thing I want to do is I want to just do a quick rundown of the topics that we're going to cover today. When you're a trader, obviously, the first thing that we need to find is direction. Is the market going to go up? Is it going to go down? Is it going to stay sideways? So what we're going to use Advanced Get. Advanced Get's been on the market since 1987, created by Tom Joseph. Been around for a very, very long time. A very, very reliable system of indicators and strategies that will help us find the good market direction. Now, once we have market direction, if we're going to trade options, the next real component is how do we trade the option on that stock? If I see a stock and I think it's going to go up based on my Elliott and my Advanced Get system, do I just buy a call? If I think it's going to go down, do I buy a put? Or is it better to enter into a credit spread like a bull put, an iron condor, a butterfly? What is the appropriate options position for that trade? Now, a big part of what we do with understanding credit versus debit is we analyze volatility. We're going to look at the volatility, compare the historic volatility to the implied volatility, and we're going to come up and we have an indicator in the options analytics tools called over and underpriced options. I'm going to give you kind of a nickel tour of how that works and how that sets up the proper options positions and show you some real life examples of why this over and underpriced concept is so important. Now, once you decide how you want to take that trade, if it's under or overpriced, I'll show you the appropriate tool in Option Analytics where we can set up the trade and we can model it, as Bennett said in the intro, all the way out to expiration. One of the things, of course, with options that you have to know is if the market goes up $5 or $6 on the underlying stock, your peak profits may not be at that $5, $6 level on your options premium. It may have peaked profitability due to, you know, theta decay at $3 or $4. What we do with our projection tool is model the trade effectively all the way to expiration day by day using a chart. And then, you know, I'll show you how all this kind of works together using our matrix tool and using the Advanced Get scanners to really combine all of our theories together. So without any further ado, let me go ahead and in the 30 minutes I have, I've got a lot of information I want to cover. Now, one thing while I'm sharing my screen and kind of switching things over, one thing I do want to mention, we do Advanced Get classes and we also do Options Analytics classes, I think on a weekly basis. I know I teach the Options Analytics class every Monday at 4 p.m. and I'll give you a link to that towards the end of the presentation. So step number one is finding market direction. Okay, we need to find market direction in order to take the appropriate trade. Now, what you're seeing right here is a daily chart updated as of yesterday on Palo Alto Networks. I want you to focus on these big blue numbers. These are the Elliott wave patterns of Palo Alto Networks. Now, going all the way back to 1987, Tom Joseph, who created Advanced Get, did a lot of research and a lot of back testing on Elliott theory. And what Tom really found was that in Elliott wave theory, the best tradable areas were waves 3, 4, and wave 5. All right. Now, everything in trading is a give and take. You look at charts and you say, man, look at that thing. It just went up, you know, 30, 40 points. How do I get into that? Well, trading is a give and take sometimes. There's often times when those big, huge moves of the market are harder to get into from a predictability standpoint. Well, what we found in our research and the testing was the peak predictability of a market is during this wave 4, right here. So what we're going to do to find the most optimal trading area, we're going to look for markets in and around this Elliott wave 4, right where I'm drawing that little square around, this place right here. Now, if you look at the bottom of the screen, you're going to notice an indicator. It's called the Advanced Get Oscillator. All this oscillator is the 535 moving average oscillator, And the key area that I want you to kind of focus on is when you see this big, large peak like we have here, okay, and then that oscillator returns back to zero right here. Because this is the peak of predictability for market trends. When we're going to try to buy into that position and have that thing rally up to a new high. So you saw Palo Alto Networks back in October rally from about 90 bucks up to about 110. And then using Advanced Get, we also have other indicators in there like the MOB tool, which will help us identify a time and price for where Wave 5 will come in. Okay, so I'm going to try to find this. Now, we call this in the Advanced Get trading system the Elliott Type 1 trade. So one of the cool features of eSignal, I'm going to jump back into replay mode, and I'm going to jump back to right here where that Wave 4 came in. And what you're going to see right around that point is a couple tools. First, you see the Wave 4. There's a profit-taking index, this red number called PTI, that needs to be greater than 35, and it's 64. And then we look for that oscillator to return back to zero. Okay. Now, one of the things with Advanced Get and our Elliott wave modeling is not a true 100% Elliott model. What we do is we optimize the model to try to find these wave fours as much as we can. If you look back here, this was back around July. This was actually a wave four according to our trading strategy as well. If I jump back there, you'll notice that we have another wave four. So every time we have that peak oscillator and that return to near zero, our software is going to try to identify the best it can a wave four to try to get you into the trend. Okay? The Elliott trigger still does work. It's just not one of the things that we use commonly anymore. And then, Michael, to your question, can you enter wave three? You can enter wave three. There's a couple things that I can show you to do that. It's not, unfortunately, today. I hate to answer the question that way because we only have 30 minutes. But there's a strategy called the XTL breakout, and I use that in conjunction with a fib level, and it's really effective for finding wave threes. All right. So now that we know that this wave four is a really good, and if you look, if I go through replay mode, you'll see that this wave four eventually does rally and starts to come into a five, and I'll just take it off for replay mode. That wave four that we got into in July ultimately ended up being a wave three anyway. See, it's not about at the end of the day, I bought into a wave four and Ron, it was supposed to be a five. Well, guess what? You bought into what we thought was a four, turned into a three, you made even more money. It's even better. It's all about finding that peak area of profit taking after a major trend. Okay? All right. So this wave four really is the critical part. This is where probability peaks with Elliott wave. So in Advanced Get, we actually have a scanner, and that's what this screen is over on the right-hand side. This scanner will allow us to find optimal type one patterns. So since this is more focused on options trading, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take my Advanced Get scanner, and I'm going to scan for nothing but Elliott type one buys on both daily and weekly charts. And you can see I can go down to 60 and 30 and 15. And then I'm only going to trade optionable stocks. So in my portfolio, I'm just going to choose optionable. And I'll hit OK. All right. So now what we've got a list of all potential type 1 trades. This is General Electric on a weekly chart. You'll see that we're in a wave 4. Oscillators back to 0. PTI is really good. Here's Applied Materials. Also a wave 4, okay, already heading up to a wave 5. Verizon Communications. All of these charts are currently in an Elliott wave 4. All right, so we've got a list of stocks that have good potential moves to the bullish side. Now, these all have direction. They all look like they're bullish stocks and they're moving up. Now we've got to put an options trade on these things, okay? So one of the things that we can do inside of this Advanced Get scanner, I can actually right-click on any of these symbols and open these into the Options Analytics tools. So I can go to Options Analytics and load it into a chart, load it into a risk graph, etc. All right. Now, we're going to actually work with some of these real-time stocks, by the way. I'm going to set up some trading opportunities. Now, before I do it, before I go into the, and I'm trying to rush in through, I'm going to go back and read questions as I can. I want to rush through and get some of these things done. What I've just done is I've switched into the options analytics. Now, in a perfect world, you're going to be running these on split screens so you can kind of see everything at once. What I want to quickly show you is an indicator that's going to be the basis for our options tools. This is going to tell us whether we should do a call. In this case, remember, we're looking for bullish stocks. So should we buy a call, or should we do a bull put spread? Should we do a butterfly? Should we do a, you know, credit-based spread? What you're looking at right here is a chart of Green Mountain Coffee. Now, on the bottom of the chart, okay, this is a tool in the options analytics program called the option over and underpriced indicator. When options are overpriced, this typically means that when we take all the averages of implied volatility across calls, puts, the different months, and we compare it to historic volatility, when implied volatility has a much greater level than historic, options become overpriced. And the histogram at the bottom will be in this sea green color. So right now on Coreg, if you're bullish on Coreg coffee, you should be doing more of a credit-based trade because options are too expensive right now. On the flip side, if I look at another stock like Ultimate Software Group, we can see that we're just coming off of overpriced options, and now the options are more reasonably priced. Now, why is this important? A lot of people look at overpriced and underpriced options, and they say, well, Ron, who cares? If I have to pay $500 for my premium versus $1,000, what's the big deal? It's just money, right? Well, it's a big deal because it can kill your profits on the trade. Now, I'm going to introduce you to our projection tool. What I've done is I've taken the stock Green Mountain Coffee on the left. This has overpriced options. I've taken Ultimate Software on the right. This has underpriced options. Now, I'm going to extend one of these screens out to the full screen. The projection tool is simulating a long call, the December 20th, 155 call, and you can kind of see that up here in the left-hand corner. Notice the price, it's $8.50. That's right at the money. Now, in this middle pane, this is the daily chart of Green Mountain Coffee. I can take this, and there's a little probability envelope over here that keeps your prices within one standard deviation. I can take this line, this is my projected line, and I can move this to various prices to simulate chart patterns. And in the panel above, this is our projected profits and losses for Green Mountain if the underlying stock moves in that direction all the way to expiration. On the you see projected volatility. Now, projected volatility is nice because a lot of times when you're putting a trade together using a graph, you simulate what volatility is going to do. But unless you can really see the history of volatility, you don't know how to model it accurately. And that's what we're going to do here. It's right now, November 14th. Well, if I take this chart back to November 14th of last year, okay, what did volatility do in November? Well, it peaked probably because of earnings. And then by late November, volatility dropped off. Well, if that happens again in late November and volatility goes back down to its low, what's going to happen to your trade? If you go a long call and just buy a call because you think Green Mountain Coffee is going to go up, even if this market goes up, you're going to lose money on the position because volatility dropped against you. This allows you to effectively calculate and project your volatility ranges. Okay? Now, let me reset all this stuff. I want to put this into a split screen. All right. So on the left was Green Mountain Coffee, overpriced options. On the right, Alt Software, underpriced options. 155 call on Green Mountain, $1.50. 155 call on Ultimate Software, $5.45. Now, so these stocks are very similarly priced. Green Mountain is 154.27. Ultimate's 154.35, so they're very, very close. Here's where overpriced and underpriced in a long call situation can hurt you. What happens if Green Mountain Coffee on the day of expiration rallies to $160? You're going to lose $402. Green Mountain Coffee just went up $6 a share, and you lost money on the trade. What happens if Ultimate Software goes up to $160? You made $15, okay? You didn't make a lot of money on Ultimate Software, but you're profitable on the trade of a $6 move. Whereas on Green Mountain, you're still down $400, even though the market went in action. Now, if this thing goes up to a one standard deviation move, you're looking at a $300 profit on Green Mountain. Your risk on the trade was $850. That was the price of the call. If this thing goes up $12 a share, you just made $300. If Ultimate goes up, you know, one standard deviation, you're looking at a $1,000 profit. That's a 2-to-1 reward risk. And it all comes back to underpriced and overpriced options. If you're playing volatility wrong, you are two steps behind the curve. You've got to have the right volatility sequence. Okay? These things that I'm talking right now, it only works for U.S. stocks, but we are expanding that the screen did not split. Shoot. Give me like 30 seconds and I'll fix this. All right, sorry about that. Fortunately, I'm really good at Adobe Connect, so I'm able to fix that real quick. Now, what I was showing you was that, you know, if Coreg only goes up to 160, you can see in the profit and loss tool, we're going to lose about $300. Whereas if Ultimate Software goes up to 160, you know, we're going to make a little bit of money on that trade. So the key is this underpriced, overpriced is really, really important. Okay? So you got to trade the right side of this. All right, now, I'm going to switch back to advanced get for just a second. Remember that list of stocks that were all type 1 trades? They're all right here in my advanced get. Now, I can just easily, if I want to take a look at SanDisk, I can right-click on SanDisk, open that in the Options Analytics chart. That'll come up to a chart inside of Options Analytics. I can easily add my overpriced, underpriced indicator. And I can see that right now, if I think that SanDisk is going to go up based on that type 1 strategy, this is a good candidate right now to just buy a call. So from advanced get, I can right click, open that in, or from the eSignal 12, I'll open that into my projection window using a long call. And if this stock goes up to the previous high, which was around 109 on this particular trade, you know, I'm risking about $350 and I have about a $950 potential profit. Okay, so SanDisk, let's take a look at that chart again in advanced get. SanDisk, if it re-goes, you know, if it goes back to that high around 110, you know, you're looking at about a $946 potential profit on SanDisk. Okay, now you can do this one by one. You know, I can, and again, understand that I'm only using one screen because of the Adobe Connect, you know, thing. I can't share both of you, so I have to go back and forth. You know, I can go right through this list and just look at each individual stock. But another thing that I can do, instead of doing that, I'm going to close all this stuff off in my Options Analytics. We have a tool called the Matrix. Now, what this Matrix can do is I can very quickly scan the market for overpriced and underpriced options. So if I want a list of overpriced options, here's a list. But what I want to do, I want to scan that list more for the advanced get type ones. So I'm going to drop this menu down, and in my scan list, I am going to insert my list from the advanced get scanner. Okay? So now what I'm doing is I'm going to scan for first underpriced options based on that list of stocks that I got from advanced get. So for those of you that just want to buy a call, these are good candidates for calls trades. SanDisk, Kirby, etc. These are all good candidates right now for just buying a call, like we looked at SanDisk. For those of you that like to do credit spreads, and I'm one of those people, I love credit spreads, I can switch scan number one from underpriced to overpriced options. Now, here's a list of options that are overpriced. Now, I'm going to set up one of my favorite trades, a bull put trade. I'm going to set my minimum price to $100 because I don't like trading cheap stocks. So I'll click scan. Now, out of those, I've got United Therapeutics and Renaissance Holding. So if I want to put together a spread on United Therapeutics, here's what I do. I right-click. I click on a tool called the Spread Select. All right. Now, what the Spread Select will do for me, I choose the spread type, and we have over 35 spreads, all sorted by market sentiment, bullish spreads, bearish spreads, and neutral. I like to do a bull put spread. What my goal is I want to sell a put underneath my Elliott Wave 4. Now remember, I've got really good potential for this stock moving up. So I want to sell an out-of-the-money put that I have no intentions of having that thing expire in the money. So I'm going to choose bull put spread, uncheck bear call spread. I'll do it in December. Or, you know, I can choose another contract month if I want. Depends on how far out you want to go. You could do weeklies too if the stock has weeklies. I'm going to build those under the current price because I want out-of-the-money puts. And then let's have it build some spreads. All right? Now, here's what the Spread Select tool is showing us. It's showing us the credit and the debit associated with the trade. One of the things that I like is I like looking at this probability. This is the probability that the trade is going to finish in the money based on volatility. So if I look, for instance, this bull put spread right here, I have a $140 credit potential with one contract with a $360 risk. Now that trade, based on probability, has a 15% chance of going against me. So that trade, based on volatility, has an 85% chance of going in my direction. So I've got the potential to make, if I take that trade 10 times and you do the rate of return, if I take that trade 10 times based off of volatility and based off the projection, if I take it 10 times, 8.5 times, I'll make $140. That's about a $1,200 profit. 1.5 times I lose $360. You know, I'm looking at about a $540 loss. So the rate of return on that trade is really, really good. Now, that's assuming that the bid and ask can get filled at that credit. You know, this trade has a little bit lower volume, but you never know. I mean, it's 240, 370. Sometimes you can get filled, sometimes you can't. That's going to be dependent on that. But if I want to project this trade into the future now, I can just right-click, and I can load that. And let me group my window and make it easier. I can load that into my projection tool. Okay, so here is United Therapeutics, okay, with my projection tool. Now, if the market goes up, I make the full credit. If I want to do it with more contracts, I can do that here, five lots. You know, it's a $700 win. Now, here's the cool part. If this market goes down, what happens if this thing sells off to 120 on the day of expiration? Still make money. What happens if it sells down to 117? I still make money. I'm going to right-click, and there's a break-even line. That break-even line is my line to where I'm going to make money on this trade. Okay, so I'm protected now. I've got a bullish pattern on United Therapeutics based on the Elliott Wave 4. And now I'm protected all the way down to 115. As long as this market doesn't go down more than $10 a share, I'm in good shape. Okay? Now, you're right, Richard, to your question, that is a big spread. And that's one of the things I would also consider in taking this trade. Now, I only have a half hour, so I can't kind of go into 30 or 40 different trade examples. So I have to kind of work with one of the first two that I have to see. But you're right, that is a big factor, and you got to take that into consideration. You got to make sure you can get filled. Or, you know, guess what? I haven't been able to get filled on some of the trades. But if you're trading a lot more actively, and by the way, there's also a scan that you can do. You know, I can take a list. I'll use that scan list that I did, that type 1 trades. And what I can also do is I can scan the individual options. So I can say, all right, search me that puts that are out of the money that have a, you know, less than 20% chance of breaking, of expiring in the money, but only show me things that have some volume. So now I've got a list of options with low probabilities that have volume. So there's a lot of different things that I can do, you know, using the different tools. Okay. John, to your question, you should have that scan. That's just the advanced get scanner. You click on new and go to scanner, and that can get that for you. Now, I know that I crammed a ton of information into 25 minutes, okay? But the two takeaways, well, a couple takeaways. Advanced get, that type 1, type 2 trade. Go to eSignal.com. You look at the suite of products that they have available. We do advanced get classes, I think, on a weekly basis. Options analytics classes we also do on a weekly basis. So, you know, today is kind of a preview of what we do. By all means, if you go to eSignal, and I'll pull up the website real quick. This is the options analytics website. If you're interested in more information, there's an options analytics class that you can log into. You know, you just go to education and events, and, you know, here's all of our classes for options and stocks and advanced getting everything. I'll give you guys this link real quick. Now, right now, we're only supporting in the options. You can look at options futures, but some of the tools on volatility are not going to work effectively. We are slowly adding futures, and hopefully in the next release, we can kind of get up to speed on futures and things. Right now, it's U.S. stock-based. If the options analytics package is something you're interested in, it's $250 a month as an add-on. That's all those tools, the matrix where you can do all the scanning and everything that you need there. And we're having a 50% off seminar special right now. So your first month is $125. And then I gave you guys that link. Yeah, and then the classes, by the way, we also do every Thursday, I do a 4 p.m. options analytics mentoring class. And what that class is basically just an overview, and we talk about real-time trades. I'll set up different scans. I show some of the different features of the program because really, and today, we only scratch the surface. You know, I only showed you some things that I can get you up and running quick to look for some trade candidates. But every Monday, we do an options analytics class at 4 p.m. It's a little bit more intensive as far as, you know, click here, here's some of the features. Thursday is our mentoring class for our clients. And the clients, you know, that allows you to come in and ask questions. We look for trade setups, et cetera.
All right. Ron, thank you so much for your time. And again, folks, I know there's a lot of questions coming in streaming to Ron right now. So my suggestion is, again, send an email to esignalproducts@interactivedata.com. In the subject line, type in attention Ben David, and I will be glad to route your questions to Ron and all of our other guest speakers today. In light of the fact that we couldn't get to all the questions that you are putting into the chat box. So again, thank you, Ron. We're going to go ahead and now, Ron, if you could hand the screen, I'm going to go ahead and formally present Jon Arps. So while I load that, give me a few minutes. Excuse me. So while this PowerPoint for Jon is loading, I wanted to formally introduce Jon Arps of Arps Traders Toolbox. Jon is the owner of the Jon Arps Traders Toolbox, where Jon converts traders worldwide. Jon is uniquely qualified to all the power and features of these trading assistants into money-making tools, tools that traders immediately recognize having been created by one of us. During Jon's presentation today, you will learn about how to identify the short, medium, and long-term trends with the ARPS triple trend. This presentation will also showcase eSignals. You'll be able to identify oscillator divergences with the ARPS auto div divergence finder. You'll quickly identify fear and greed-driven volume price relationships, and you'll be able to take advantage of unique impending end of trend signals. Again, in order to keep Jon's presentation flowing well, I ask that you please hold your questions until the end of the presentation. We'll try and save room for Jon to respond to you in due time. With those final details aside, please welcome Jon Arps. And again, thank you for attending Back in Black webinar. Jon, off to you.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me all right? Testing, testing.
We can hear you just fine, Jon.
All right, great. Well, it's a pleasure to be here today, and it's also interesting to be following off of the Advanced Get presentation, because actually Tom Joseph, the founder of Advanced Get, was instrumental in bringing me into the eSignal family and incorporating a lot of my tools into eSignal. So again, thank you eSignal for having me here, and thank you Tom Joseph for making it possible. Well, let me start by introducing myself. There's a little picture of me. I've been trading for over 50 years. I actually started in high school, and this was before computers and before a lot of automated stuff. And my dad
It looks like we're not seeing your screen at this time. So can either you or Craig load your screen or document?
Well, my screen is there. I just got to get you.
You need to share your screen or your document through Adobe Connect.
All right, where do I share my screen then? Oh, here it is. I'm sorry. Oh, I've got it. I beg your pardon.
Perfect. Okay, guys. Sorry, Jon. Go ahead.
Can you see my... Let me go back to my slide there. Can you...
We lost it again. Go ahead and share your screen, Jon.
Yes, your screen just a moment.
Okay.
I'm clicking on share my screen, but when I do that, I don't get what I'm sharing.
It looks like it's loading right now.
Can you see my slide now?
It is still loading at this time. Jon, as a backup, do you want to email me, either you or Craig, email me your slides and I'll share on my end?
You should be able to see them. They're up now. I'm going to go back to the page where it says share your screen.
Okay. Which, it could be a case where, do you have dual monitors right now, Jon?
Yes.
Okay, which screen are you sharing? That might be the issue.
Screen number one.
And that's the one where your presentation is sitting, right?
First monitor, desktop, applications, Windows, share.
Okay. There you go.
All right, okay. And let me go back to the beginning here. Okay, see a big picture now? Hello, do you see my front of my slide?
Yep, we got it. Everyone's chatting in right now. Go ahead, Jon, begin your presentation.
All right. Okay, well, I've been trading for 50 years. I founded Jon Arps Traders Toolbox in 1991 to develop custom trading tools that were currently not available. As it mentions there, I was also asked by the Complete Idiot's Guide people to write a book about technical analysis, The Complete Idiot's Guide to Technical Analysis. So unless you guys are idiots, you don't really want that book. But anyway, it's a good book. I'd also like to introduce my partner and son, Craig Arps. He's the good-looking guy on the left holding my shoulder. And Craig is the Vice President of Traders Toolbox and soon to be the heir to Jon Arps Traders Toolbox. And Craig is online here to answer any of your questions so that I don't have to interrupt my presentation and to be of help in that direction. So, hi Craig, hope you're there and we'll be talking to you. Now, about 10 years ago, when eSignal contacted me to see if they could include some of my tools on the platform, we were looking at what's there now and what I have that might work. And they said, just give me the best stuff you have. And so we called that the ARPS Crown Jewels. And we ended up with a list of tools that you see now on the screen. Those in red are my favorites, and those in black are there as well. But you can see there's quite a collection of tools. And we're going to go talk a little bit about how they work, what they're good for, and give you an insight into how to use them on eSignal. The key tools that I like the most out of this set of ARPS crown jewels are the ARPS triple trender, the trender pullback, the pullback 23, the auto divergence, trend line breakouts, bull and bear flags, radar 1 fear greed, radar 2 price leader, and radar 3 trend strength index. Now, my trading style is I'm a trend trader. I look for the beginnings of impending trends, and so I have tools that identify the beginnings of a trend. And then I also like to trade pullbacks in a trend, and we'll talk some more about that as we go along. My exits depend a lot on some of the proprietary tools that we have in this list that look at when the trend is running out of steam and when it's likely to reverse. So what we look for, first of all, are trend identifiers, the ARPS trender, the triple trender, and the radar 3 trend strength index. And we'll look at those in just a minute. Then we have market sentiment identifiers, timing tools, and setup identifiers. So let's start with timing tools for a minute. You know, people are always asking me, well, are these tools of yours leading tools, lagging tools? When do the signals show up and so forth? Well, one of the best tools that is a leading indicator is the Radar 2 Price Acceleration Oscillator. And what it does is it measures the rate of change of momentum. In other words, the second derivative of price, which is acceleration. If you think of it this way, if you're driving your car and you know you have a speedometer and you have a tachometer. Now, the speedometer tells you how fast you're going. And as you take, and when you push on the gas, you speed up, and you take your foot off the gas, it slows down. But what does the tachometer do? In fact, I think most of us don't really look at the tachometer that much. But if you do, you'll see that it is a leading indicator. It's measuring when you're pushing on the accelerator, even before the car starts to speed up. So if you're driving behind a slow truck and you're going to pass him, you jam down on the accelerator, your motor revs up, and little by little, your speed and speedometer increases. So we have developed this Radar 2 Price Acceleration Oscillator, which you see at the bottom of the screen here. It's a green and red light. It looks a little like a stochastic. It's a fast and a slow, and it's measuring price acceleration. So it usually leads, if we look at, for example, this point right here, the acceleration oscillator has already started to move up and anticipating the move in the price. And then we have trend exhaustion 1, which is a show me indicator, plots dots on the chart when it detects these. The red is it's beginning to decelerate, and the blue, the price is beginning to accelerate. So we trigger our trades many times on these trend exhaustion 1 signals that are generated by the price acceleration oscillator. Here you can see the second thing that we use this acceleration oscillator about, and we're going to be talking about that some more later, is it's a diverging tool. So as the price is going up, as you see here with the blue line, that's reflected on the oscillator with a blue line going down. So that's an inverse divergence. Then we have a divergence here where we're getting close to the top, and you can see that the price acceleration oscillator is already diverging to the downside. So it's a very good diverging oscillator. And as a matter of fact, we'll go a little bit later into our automatic divergence detector. Here's another example of the same kind of thing with the divergence signals, and they're pretty darn good as far as telling me when the trend is ready to reverse. So for trend identifiers, I'm going to move on now to the ARPS trender, which talks about or measures the strength of the trend. This is our ARPS trender tool. Now you'll see it in two versions, either a solid line like we have right now, or it can be a stair step line, and we'll see them in the different images. The ARPS trender is a statistically based tool, very sophisticated algorithm that looks at, among other things, the average true range. It looks at the rate of change in price. It looks at a number of different things, and then plots this red or blue line, depending on whether you're in an uptrend or a downtrend, just far enough away from the price so that it doesn't get triggered by random noise. This is also a very good trailing stop tool, and we use it all the time for that as well. One of the things you will notice, if you can see my arrow right here, when the price penetrates the red line, it doesn't trigger it. The price has to, in other words, doesn't trigger it in the other direction. The price has to close above the red line or close below the blue line in order for it to reverse direction. And the ARPS trender basically has one input, and that's called sensitivity. And it's a number from 1 to 10, and it's just like the volume control on your radio. 1 is very sensitive, 10 is very insensitive. So in this particular example, the sensitivity is set to 4. Now, when we change it to 1, you can see that the trender is quite a bit closer to the price and is going to get triggered more quickly. So we can adjust the sensitivity of the ARPS trender to define the strength of the trend. And basically, the lower the number, the more sensitive it is. So we're looking at short-term trends. The higher the sensitivity number, the farther away from the price it is, and therefore we're looking at longer-term trends. Now, what I've done is created a triple trender tool so that I can look at both the long-term, medium-term, and short-term trends, and that's what you're looking at here. You can see the closest line is a line that has a very low sensitivity number, and that's our short-term trend. The medium line, the midline, is our medium-term trend, and the blue line is our long-term trend. So in this case, if we were looking at this particular chart, we could see that the long-term trend actually runs from over here on the left all the way up to the peak before it starts to turn around. So I might be riding the long-term trend and then either wait for all three of them to be triggered before I go short, or go short or get out when the short-term trend is triggered. Now, underneath that, I have another tool, an oscillator, which is this histogram. And the histogram, green up, red down, is also overlaid by the price acceleration oscillator that we looked at before. So we're comparing both the radar 1 fear greed indicator with the price acceleration oscillator. Now, what is the fear greed indicator? Well, what it does, it integrates volume and price. You know, normally we look at a chart, and there's a price chart, and underneath it is a volume chart. And we have to kind of look at both of them and see whether the price is going up on rising volume or going down. Well, basically, I've automated that process to where now the Radar 1 Fear Greed Index looks at how much volume does it take to move the price up a point versus how much volume does it take to move the price down a point in that same zone. And so if it goes up easier than it goes down, that means that the bulls are in control, and it's like a tug of war. So the bulls are winning that one. If the bars are red and pointing down, then the bears are in control, and they are pulling the market back down. So it's a very good tool to look at to say, is this a good time to buy? Is it a good time to sell? If we look right here where it says Radar 1 Fear Greed, the green bars are coming up, and therefore the path of least resistance is up. It's a good time to buy. When we start seeing a divergence, which we can see right here, if we look at this, this is the peak of bullishness, which corresponds to this. But then even though the price is still going up, the bears are taking control, and you can see that the strength of the bulls is less than it was back here. So we see a clear divergence and a clear signal that if we were long in this trend, we should be thinking about when we see these lower highs in the green bars of the fear greed, we need to be thinking about getting out. And then that's also supported by the triple trender, which we see here. The prices have reversed through the triple trender and are on their way down. Here's the ARPS trender with a sensitivity of 1. We talked about it's very sensitive. It's going to flip you back and forth. But nonetheless, if you trade with the trend, then this is going to tell you what the short-term trend is. Now let's talk about trend identifiers in a different way. Market sentiment identifiers, timing tools, and setup identifiers. These are four of the tools that I always want to be having on my chart or having available to me. So the market sentiment identifier, which we just talked about, is Radar 1, the fear greed indicator, which tells me whether the bulls or the bears are in control. My trading style, as I've mentioned, is to trade breakouts from congestion. So anytime I see a congestion zone in the prices, some traders refer to it as a squeeze. It's a very good way to talk about it. But we're always looking for a breakout from that congestion. The second thing we look for is pullbacks in a trend. Most trends have a pullback. And if we can identify that pullback, then we can get into the market on the next leg of the trend. And the third one is looking for trend exhaustions. We need a tool that can tell us when the trend is about over. And I showed you some of those with the fear greed indicator diverging from price or the Radar 2 price acceleration index rolling over. You know, people always say the trend is your friend, and my corollary is you don't really know you're in a trend until you're in a trend. There's lots of times when you get little moves and you think, okay, this is it, but then it'll just turn right around and go back down again. So we need to know as soon as we can whether or not we're in a trend. And what I talked about a minute ago was breakout from congestion. Here's a good example of that. You're in a sideways move. Once it breaks out of that and starts to move on up, then we can determine that we're probably in a trend. The second place to identify a good trend is when you come to a pullback. So here we have a pullback. here we have a trend going up, then a little pullback, and then some more trend is going up. And we have several tools to identify these pullbacks and distinguish them from a trend reversal. And I'll show you those in a moment. We do have some trend exhaustion tools, trend exhaustion 1, trend exhaustion 2, trend exhaustion 3. I can't go into the details right now because there's not that much time about how each of them works, but you can see the little dots that show up when these trend exhaustion signals are detected in the price. So what do we need to know? Well, we need to know whether we're trending or consolidating. We need to know what the longer-term trend direction is and what the shorter-term trend direction is. And we've talked about the ARPS trender in detail now with the different sensitivities to help us identify what kind of a trend we're in at any particular time. There's the ARPS trender again. Here it is in a different format. It's a stair-step format, which I like because it's easier to identify that is the ARPS trender and distinguish it from other lines that might be on the chart. But again, you can see how useful the ARPS trender is in staying just far enough away from the price so that it's not going to get triggered and flipped until the price actually has reversed. And it keeps you in the trend for most of the juicy parts of the trend. Underneath that, you see the ARPS Radar 1 Fear Greed again. You can see nice divergences. For example, if we look at this peak in price over here to the left and then another peak to the right, which is a little bit higher, but the Radar 1 Fear Greed definitely has a lower second peak than it does the first one. So it's telling us that the bulls are not as strong at that second peak as they were at the first peak. At the same time, when we reach the low, where it says PB23 here, there is almost no volume, either bullish or bearish. So this is sort of like a doji. And then when we start to see the bulls taking control and more the bullishness increases, and it supports the fact that we broke the ARPS trender to the downside, broke the red ARPS trender. It's going up. Everything is going up. And then at the peak, we see a big gap down, which was really not anticipated that much with the fear greed index in this case. So once again, if we look at how to use the ARPS triple trender, when all three of them are on the upside, the blue, the green, the red, that's the short term, the medium term, and the long term, that's where it's time to go long. When we get up here and the price breaks through the short term trender, then that's a good idea to get step aside and to get out. Then again, we go long and we break the short-term trender here, which would be a second place to go to get out. And the same thing happens on the inverse side if we're short. If it breaks a short, we might exit, only get in when all three of them are in agreement. Now, another signal that is very useful is a pullback in a trend. And here we have a little tool that's called the ARPS Trender Pullback. It plots a dot. And when does it plot a dot? It plots a dot if the close penetrates the ARPS Trender, but not if it doesn't. TPB means trender pullback. So in this case, we had a trender pullback. It penetrated the trender, but it didn't close below it. So this is considered to be a pullback in a trend. The trend runs up very nicely, as you can see. And then here we have another little trend or pullback. The price penetrated through the short-term trender, but it didn't close there. It closed above it. So that's a TPB, that's a trender pullback signal, buy signal, and is an indication that the trend has not yet finished its move, the uptrend. We're moving pretty fast here because time is very short. We have another tool that's called a pullback 23, which looks at a different kind of a pullback into the trend, and it signals pullbacks in a trend. So all of these blue PB23s are bullish buy signals. Now, another thing to look at with trends and patterns, market patterns repeat themselves over and over again because people are people, and they're basically based on human behavior, human emotions. And one of the tools that, or one of the patterns that traders look for as possible pullbacks in a trend are bull and bear flags. And here's an example of a bear flag, the yellow flag at the top. We call the long yellow line the flagpole, and then the two short lines are the flag themselves. And when it breaks out of the flag, then we can also use a tool to project where the target is. And basically what we do is look at the length of the flagpole and add it to the breakout and plot a line where that distance would be. And that is our trading target, which is often pretty useful. It's called a measured move. And here's an excellent example where the tool has detected a flag and then looked at a break, saw the breakout, plotted the target down here where this first yellow dot is, and sure enough, the flag, the extension moved down to it. Similarly, our automated flag detection tool saw a flag here. And once it saw this pattern, it waited for a breakout of the top of the flag. And you see that in a little blue dot right here. And when it breaks out, then it can plot the price target, which are these four little blue dots here, and that would be our flag target. So we have this automatic tool that looks for flag patterns, calculates the price target, plots it, both on a chart like this, but also on a scanner, which we'll look at later, that would tell us where the measured move price target is. So one of the things that I want to stress is that a lot of the stuff that a lot of traders do by eye, what we've tried to do is to automate that, to develop tools that anytime a flag occurs, it registers, it lets you know, it signals you with an alert, and then it will signal where the target is likely to be. Here's an example of how that works then. So we have a flag breakout right here. It then, at this point, calculates a target where these dots are beginning to plot. And once the price reaches the target, odds are that it's going to slow down. So we either look for a trend exhaustion signal or we just automatically get out. It makes for a very nice little automated system. Here's the similar pattern on the downside. We get a flagpole. We get a flag pattern. Here's the flag breakout. And here's the breakdown target. So the tool does this automatically. Of course, it doesn't put the labels on. Those are done after the fact. But the dots and the lines and so forth are done in real time as these patterns occur. Now, another thing that we traders are always looking for, and I alluded to that a little bit earlier, is divergence between the price and the oscillator. And instead of just doing that by eye, we have several divergence tools that basically will look for divergences between price and an oscillator. And we have found not only are double dip divergences popular, but very effective are triple dip, triple bump divergences, so that we look for three peaks diverging from three valleys in the tool diverging from three peaks in the oscillator. Here's an example of a divergence. Very obvious, the radar one fear greed. This part of the trend is with enthusiasm. It pulls back when it goes up and makes the next high. It does it on much less enthusiasm. So when I see that as I'm looking at my fear greed, I'm saying we're running out of steam. It's time to get out of my longs. Vice versa, here we have a low. The fear greed oscillator is beginning to diverge from the price, and we're getting more and more bullish. So this would be a good place to go long. Here's another good example. The fear greed is one of my favorite indicators because it really does diverge nicely from price. And here you can see we had a very strong rally going all the way up. But as we get near the top of the rally, it peaks and starts, and the radar one fear greed starts to roll over before the price does. So this is a good indication that if we were long, this is where we want to get out. Now, at the very end here, we don't know for sure whether it's going to go up or down. But again, as we look at the fear greed, we see that the bears are losing control. They're getting weaker and weaker. The bulls are beginning to take over. And any minute now, these lines are going to turn green. And so we better get out of our short and start thinking long. Here, again, are the results of our automated divergence tool. In this particular case, we're not looking, and we don't see the oscillator, but the oscillator is there in the calculation, and it's giving the signals that we either have a pivot divergence, which is higher highs in the price and lower highs in the oscillator, or we have a trend divergence, which is lower highs in the price and higher highs in the oscillator. And these are plotted automatically. Now, we talked a little bit earlier about the radar 2 price leader, where we're looking at changes in the acceleration of price momentum. And here is a chart that uses several of the tools that we've talked about. There's the radar 1 fear greed. Here is the price leader. That's the acceleration oscillator. Whenever we get a rollover, we're looking at prices slowing down. For example, let's say you're driving down the highway and you come up behind a big truck. And what do? You take your foot off the gas. Well, some of you probably would jam down on the gas to try to zip past it, but the conservative driver is going to take his foot off the gas, and that's what we're looking at right here, the position of your foot on the accelerator. So you're slowing down, you're slowing down, and the price is going right along with it. And you can see, again, many of these charts have the ARPS trender on it, which is the red and blue stair steps, and they also may have a pullback 23, which is another one of our tools that's looking for price pullbacks and plots those on the chart. I know I'm going very fast here, but time's flying, and I need to kind of stay on the calendar, on the clock. So the two now, the next thing is to look at multiple system symbols. If I'm comparing a number of system symbols against one another, the question that is raised is, how has this symbol performed recently relative to alternative choices? And which symbol is likely to be the strongest or the weakest in an upcoming time frame? And one of the tools that we use for that is the triple trender, but we use it in a matrix, like the scanner. And here's an example of how this matrix works. This is our triple trender, and it's color-coded, isn't it? It's either pink, it's light green, or dark green. And those tell me at a glance what's going on. If the cell is, well, first of all, if the cell is strongly up, it's green. If the trender is strongly down, it's red. We're talking about the short-term trender now. And then we can look at the medium-term trender. And if it's dark green, it's strong up. If it's red, as it is down here, it's strong down. Now, what are these light green squares and pink squares? Well, that's it's up, but it's sideways. So it's a weak up. And if it's pink, it's a weak down. Now, the next thing I can do is I have something here called the score. And the score is from 1 to 6. A score of 1 is a weak down. A score of 0 is neutral. A score of 6 is a very strong up, and a score of -6 would be a very strong down. Each of these cells I assign a score to. If it's a strong up dark green, I give it 2 points. If it's a weak up light green, I give it 1 point. If it's a strong down red, I give it -2 points. And if it's a weak down, like this pink, I give it a -1 point. So now I can add those scores across. Let's look at EFTC again. Lost my cursor here. ETFC. The short-term trend is a weak down, so I'm going to give it a -1 point. The medium-term trend is a weak up, so that's a +1 point. And the long-term trend is a weak up, so that's a +1 point. So if I take a -1 for the short term, a +1 for the medium term, and a +1 for the long term, that totals to -1, +1 is 0, +1 is 1. So my score there is 1. By the same token, if we look at GVA, the short term trend is strong long, so it gets 2 points. The medium term is pink, it gets -1 point. And the long term is pink, so it's another -1 point. So if we take +2, -1, -1, that score is 0. So if I'm looking at this GVA stock, it's neutral right now. It's neither long nor, it's neither strong long nor strong short, so it's just a neutral. So I can sort on this column and bring all the sixes to the top, for example. Sixes would be 2+2+2, which is as strong as you can get on the long side. And the -6s, which is the opposite, -2, -2, -2, that's a strong downside movement. So these numbers within the squares are how many bars they have been in this condition. So the medium term in this first one has been sort of normal for the last 23 bars. That's telling me this is a sideways stock, and I could trade it accordingly. Maybe it's in a congestion area, and if I click on the symbol, it's going to give me the chart, and I can look at those very easily through using this scanner approach. Now, if we look at these indicators and see, well, just how effective have they been? And one of the ways to do that is to use the scanner and apply the tools and see how many of them were winners, that is, from the time that they gave us a signal to the time that they gave us a reversal signal. You can see these different tools, the short-term trender, the medium-term trender, the long-term trender, the pullback 23, the automatic divergence, the trend line break, which we haven't talked about, the flags tools, and the trend exhaustion 1 tools. So in almost every case, well, this is the key that you want to look at. These tools have generally given us 77, 76, 72, 50%, 76, 76, 83, 63. So almost all of them are 70% or better accurate in predicting a potentially profitable trade. So to summarize again, my 9 key tools are the ARPS triple trender, the ARPS trender pullback, the ARPS pullback 23, the ARPS automatic divergence detector, the trend line breakouts, the bull and bear flags, radar 1 fear greed, radar 2 price leader, and radar 3 trend strength index. So that's it. Here's my deal. All of these tools are built into the eSignal platform. I'm sorry, that's not right. Well, we lost the slide that we were going to talk about. These are built into the eSignal platform. They lease for $95 a month. The first month is $20, so you can try them out to see if they work. To order the tools, you order them directly through the eSignal website on their partner's website, and that's it.
Okay, Jon, thank you so much. And folks, we're short on time, and we need to queue up our next presenter, Dan Zanger from Chart Pattern. Again, in terms of your questions, please send an email to eSignalProducts@interactivedata.com. In the subject line, mention attention Ben David, and I'll route your questions to the appropriate guest presenter, and we'll respond back to you via the email address. At this time, I wanted to formally, Jon, if you could kindly give me back control, I'm going to go ahead and present my next set of slides.
Of course. How do I do it?
You should have gotten a pop-up that says, I'm requesting control. You go. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So folks, give me a moment while I load up Dan Zanger from Chart Pattern's presentation. Folks, as I load my first set of slides for Dan, I wanted to formally introduce again Dan Zanger from Chart Pattern.
Hello.
Let me read off Dan's bio. Analyst for the stock website chartpattern.com and Zanger Report Newsletter. Dan holds the record for the largest percentage change for a personal stock portfolio over an 18-month period a feat achieved by turning $10,775 into an audited gain of $18 million in just 18 months. A former pool contractor, the world first learned of his trading achievements in an article that appeared in Fortune magazine back in December 2000 entitled, "My Stocks Are Up 10,000%. Dan spent 25 years devoting every spare moment to studying charts. Using chart patterns combined with observed price and volume behaviors, Dan eventually developed a robust trading system that responds to all market conditions. Dan has been voted in the top 100 Trader of the Year by Trader Monthly magazine 2 years in a row. He has been featured in such publications as Barron's, Forbes, Fortune, Active Trader, Trader Monthly, and Trader World. He's a frequent contributor to technical analysis of Stocks and Commodities magazine and SFL magazine. Dan also teaches a one-day trading seminar each year highlighting the most powerful chart patterns to help new and seasoned traders alike. His seminars sell out to standing room only crowds each year. During Dan's presentation today, you will learn about how to see how Dan sets up his eSignal quote screen to read the action in leading stocks, learn to use the pre-market and spot potential big movers, trade simple patterns to catch the trend with small stops, and more. Again, as a final reminder, in order to keep Dan's presentation going well, I ask that you please hold your questions till the end of the presentation. Please go ahead and send your questions through the chat box, and Dan and I will try and respond in due time. Dan, off to you.
Okay, how are you doing there? Everybody hear me?
Yes, we can, Dan. And we're seeing you now loading your documents.
All right. Okay. Are we good?
Dan, start your presentation.
Okay, so this is me here, my website, chartpattern.com. I've been doing this for 15 years, 17 years. I'm doing that many more years than that prior to starting the website. I think I was the first Momentum website in the web, which is why I started the website. And people encouraged me to start the website because they were amazed at my stock picks. So, you know, that's the reason why I got going doing this. And this is the site. We have many things here on the site. All of my magazines. There's many articles in here that they've done on me. Traders World, Fortune, Forbes, you name it. They're all there. It's great reading. Stocks and Commodities magazine, my very first large article, is really a fabulous read. You can click that on and read that. I highly suggest that. So much information in there insofar as little tidbits of how to pick up when stocks are feeling good, when they're not feeling good, merely because they are have some sort of a MACD crossover or this or that, doesn't mean you're going to make any money on the stock. You could get a MACD cross and the stock just sit there while another stock rips 30, 50 points. So, you know, we're not. That's really what I characterize as the difference between me and other individuals using lots of fancy goodies. So I use a lot of fancy goodies. I'm your basic momentum trader. Volume is my key. It's volume, it's price action, it's behavior. Stocks will really tell you when they're ready to get up and run, and they'll just tell you when they're just going to roll over and not do anything, such as YY had a nice little pattern waiting, similar to BITA, B-I-T-A. This past week, both had great earnings, and YY rolled right over and never cleared my technical buy area, and BITA just soared right through it. So that's we got to get this to move. Let's go to the next slide somehow. Working on that, folks. And just give me 1 minute. So we're kind of having a little technical problem here. There we go. And anyway, this is my bio, which you already introduced here, turning 10,000. And it's just basic, simple stuff. When I learned, I really just had basic chart patterns. I mean, I started really about 1989. There was really no computers and stuff like that. I had to get printed charts from daily graphs. That was the only way. So I used just basic tools of chart patterns and volume acceleration to capture the leading stocks during large swing trends. Market becomes very choppy or bearish. I generally stay pretty much in cash. I feel that this market is very, very choppy. You can be in a stock, one of these big fast momentum stocks just gaps down 6 or 7, kind of rallies up 3 or 4, and then fades off 20 by the end of the day, which is what Dan did the other day. Fortunately, I was out of that when the stock was down. It plunged 20 by the end of the day, so that one didn't work out very well. I use eSignal. I've used eSignal for 15 years. There's just no finer provider of accurate real-time information. I just love their quote screen. The way that I have it set up and my intense focus allows me to clearly see what they are moving the stock with, the types of volume. We go to this chart here. This is how I have my quote screen set up. We have the symbol here. Of course, I like to have the fastest moving stocks in the market on the top left of my screen. Let's say the top 6 or 8 are when we marked up this chart. This was what I was looking at the time. Of course, Baba, you know, is a monster mover. I had that on my website. It was a buy at $92. The stock roared to 120. You know, it's hard not to make a lot of money when you have a lot of money on the one big moving stock in the market that makes that big move. You know, you can have a lot of frivolous little movers. You know, I call them popcorn movers here and there. You don't really get any action out of them. You're waiting 2 or 3 months. Meanwhile, Baba just soars 30, or the Netflix in my website that I had that 320, it roared to 420. I get a quick 100 points in a month's period of time. You know, that is how I made all my money. I continue to make all my money, even to this day, trading just a couple of stocks and not having a broad variety of stocks with lots of little, positions. I like to have a concentration in 2 or 3 stocks. Maybe there'll be 4 or 5 stocks. Every market is different. You have some very powerful markets that are lifting all stocks, such as the start of a new bull market, either in 2003, 96, certainly in the bottom of March of 2009 was the bottom. Meanwhile, Priceline had already started its big run at $85. I showed that in my website. Matter of fact, Priceline was running for 3 months in an upward fashion while the market was still moving down. So you knew right away that Priceline was ultra strong. And that was one of the first stocks I highlighted at my website, coming out of a nice little base at $85, $86. All of my newsletters, all of my stock selections are in my website from the day the website started back in August of 1998. You can go back into the newsletter archives in the member login area, research all your favorite stocks. I have a complete historical database of all the winners that you'll ever see, the Googles, the early Baidu that went from, you know, ran $1,000. Certainly it set up a nice cup and handle, and it ripped 250 points on me in about 6 weeks. So that was a big moving stock. I was loaded out of wazoo in that one. So at any rate, let's get to how I set the thing up here. I have a list of my symbols, the best moving stocks, and then I have the last trade, the current trade of the day, the change of the day. You know, I want to know what stocks, these stocks should be moving $6, $7, $8 in a day. Not $1 a day, $1.50, $2. That put me right to sleep. You know, there are other people who like that. That's just not me. So what I'm telling you may not be for you, but I know for many people, they want to make as most money as they can in a shorter period of time, and you know, would like to go golfing or boating or shopping or doing something else while the market is basically just doing nothing. So I like to see that a stock has a big change. It can make big changes, so I'm always seeking stocks that make the biggest changes, and I have the change right here. Then I have the bid and the ask, so I can clearly see here what is going on with the bid and the ask. And I like to read the spread between the bid and the ask. If a stock is very liquid, like a BABA trading 30, 40, 50 million shares a day, or a Facebook or something, I monitor the spread. If the spread starts to get wide, market makers start to get scared, the spread starts to open up. That's a lot of weakness probably is going to come into the market if you see the spread start to open up here. Of course, I have the volume here. The volume is the most important thing. It's what moves stocks. Your stock is not going to move up without a lot of volume pushing it up. That's how they go up. It's not mad, not helium. It's volume. I mean, for many of you, you're saying, okay, Dan, I understand that. You know, but for many people, they don't really take volume seriously and don't key in on it and make it a priority in their focus throughout the entire day. Then the next one over is I have the average volume. I like to run 20-day average. Some people use 25-day. eSignal here is set up for 25 days. So this is the most recent average over the last 25 days, and I would like to see, and I like to divide my day up. Their morning will have more volume. People come into the market. The morning is typically for rookies. The institutions get a read on the rookies and see how they're treating the market, if there's a lot of froth in the market, a lot of early maps that I consider that froth or news-driven. There are selected times when you'll see early gap ups with very light volume. Volume will come in later. Futures have gapped up large, so the stocks will gap up. If the stocks hold their gap, then the stock can turn and run. That would be an opening range breakout. So for me, keying in on the volume is everything. And I just look at this screen all day long with such intense focus. People can walk into the room. I don't even know it. I don't take phone calls. I do chat in my chat room periodically. But being laser focused on these changes here that I'm talking about is everything to me. I can be out of a stock quickly by just noticing subtle changes that are taking place in the volume and the bid ask. And then I can combine that with a chart. I keep a chart open in the lower right. Of course, I have 8 monitors running. This is, I have many more charts, and you can set up many more charts in various time frames with your eSignal on other monitors. And stay tuned with what's going on with your charts and your volume. But I would say 80% of my time I'm focused in on this one particular screen all day long. It is by far the most important screen for me. It's hard to say. Doing my homework at night, studying the chart patterns, but in the day, let's see the volume, let's see the price action, and let's see the bid and ask behavior and the percentage of volume very early in the day. As the day goes on, you have your double martini breaks, or triple martini breaks for the institutions. Let's say they're going to lunch. They leave a few traders behind. But basically, lunchtime, things begin to slow down. Late afternoon, you have a lot of institutions wanting to come in, and they want to make sure, because they have large positions, you know, they're owning, 600,000 shares of stock, 6.8 million shares of stock, 12 million shares, whatever it is, 5%, 8% of the company, 3%. And they want to make sure that the stock is looking good on the chart of the day. So they save a lot of their firepower for the end of the day. The terminology is that rookies trade the morning market and the institutions trade the afternoon market, because the institutions want to assure that that stock closes at or above a specific point or at or below a specific point to make sure that the charts are looking either bullish or bearish. And this, when other people start to scan through their stocks in the nighttime, or other institutions or traders or technical guys such as myself, will see, you know, what the institutions are doing. So there's a lot of patterns, a lot of formations, a lot of song and dance, but with the patterns. But if a stock is starting to drift maybe below a certain area, you might see in the last 5 minutes of the day that stock just rips right back up, And just like, voila, it's amazing. How did that stock close up three in the last 5 minutes of the day? Well, it didn't take a lot of money, and there wasn't a lot of people fighting because everybody else walked away, and then someone came in and ripped that stock up in the last minutes of the day to assure that, let's say, that that stock closed above a 50-day moving average line, 21-day moving average line, or whatever point that they felt that it needed to close at. Or conversely, you may have somebody who's a large short seller hammering a stock, trying to get it to close below a 50-day, so it becomes more bearish and try and bring in sellers because they're very short. So there's always a lot of dogfighting going on in the stock right at the end of the day, and you need to know what it is that they're trying to fight for. So that's why you take a look at your 50-day moving average, 21-day, or your 100-day, or whatever that might be. We can go to the next chart here, and go to a hot list. And this is just sorting through the day. This is just gives me a scan on which stocks have a lot of volume. So this is just telling me which stocks have a volume that is maybe 100% or 200%. Its run rate. What is its run rate? So it's calculating every 5 minute bar, and it may have a run rate after 20 bars, 20 times 5, and it will have a run rate that it is 100% above normal. So you know that a particular stock is getting a lot of action, and you just got a nice sort right here. Some of these stocks I wouldn't touch. They're just not of interest to me, but let's say I'll see a Bamba start to creep up after it's come down 4 or 5 days, and all of a sudden it has an up day and the volume is beginning to expand. Or I might find, let's say, a SanDisk is doing well, or one of these other stocks, or a stock is beginning to have heavy run rate on the volume and it's selling off. So, you know, I like to keep in touch periodically throughout the day using this, and I can just see if I touch on a stock with the symbol, with the cursor here, it'll bring up the screen of that stock, so I can quickly just scan through this and see exactly what the chart looks like and what it is that the institutions may be doing or the news of the day may be doing. You'll see a lot of stocks with news on the day. The stock moves up big one day, and then the next day, you know, it was, a lot of rookies and people just jumping in on the bandwagon just because it's up or because somebody else is, you know, some news story, and the next day the stock has no volume and it starts to just collapse. This is one of the biggest mistakes I see. I see it, I think, every day, if not every day, every other day in my chat room, rookies wanting to jump on a stock for merely because it's up on the day and it has large volume. Meanwhile, the stock is 30% or 40% off its high, so you have hundreds, if not thousands, of people wanting to step in and sell. The minute the volume dries up, that stock just gets crushed. So you really have to put a package together of the volume combined with the chart. How long is it moving sideways, horizontal, where is support, what are the daily bars looking like? You know, what is the overall market looking like? Is it an earnings news? Is it a news event? Is it just breaking out? It's just time to go. Let me see here. We have various day counts going. We have, there's so much information. You can get information overload, and then you don't really focus in on a lot of stuff that is really meaningful. The most meaningful thing is the volume and a stock breaking out of a consolidation. And you want a high beta stock? I think that's priority. You have to have a high beta stock breaking out. And on to charts, and then you can set up charts. You can have multiple screens. I run 8 monitors, 8 24-inch monitors. I have more information than a computer can analyze during the day. It is overwhelming. I think if you have a good four monitors and one box. We like to run trading computers. They have very high speed computers running processing, and they last a long time. So I can recommend them. If you need to get into one box situation where you can get four big monitors, and then you can break up your e-signal and go on all the various monitors in different time frames. So that's always very good. I like to draw charts during the day and look at charts. First of all, in the nighttime, I'll probably spend 2 to 3 hours in the nighttime. I like to manually flip through and scan anywhere between 600 to 1,200 stocks. I like to look at them in detail, spend as much time as I can. A lot of them are just frivolous charts of no value. They may just be in a group. Let's say years ago in the mid-2004 when China was buying a lot of raw materials and building the Olympics, building out cities and stuff, you know, copper was hot. Shipping stocks were transporting copper and iron ore. So, you know, you could just get a sense by scanning through a lot of stocks which groups were hot. Now, and once you get the group that's hot, which is the number one hot stock in the hot group, now you're starting to really focus in on what's popular, what's hot, what's supported, what is going to be bought on dips, what's going to really start to make your portfolio really come to life and expand. So here's a whole set of charts. I'll mark them up in the nighttime. They're running in real time. I see my volume on my other screen, and then I can come over and look at charts here that I've already preset up. Why is it breaking out? Is it coming through a trend line? Like, let's say here, this one's gapping up through the trend, the buy point here, 102, clears the buy point, heavy volume, you have a gap. I don't need to own 25 stocks. Here's a big cap stock breaking out, super earnings, raising guidance, and, you know, leader in the group, new products, global stock, global products, and, you know, it's like a number one go-to type stock. BABA is also a similar stock, another global stock in Asia. I'm sure it's going to expand everywhere else globally. This stock has massive potential. And I set the trend line because it goes back and forth down here. Everybody sees it to some degree, but it needs time. You know, had a big sell-off. It had a huge number of shares to be sold by insiders. Institutions were buying and trading it off, and they just sell it down, but then you create a base. And as soon as it breaks through the base here at 92, off to the races we went. It goes from 92 to 120 here in 2 to 3 weeks. I don't know how much more money you can spend with something like this. Why do you have 10 other stocks when you can have 20 or 30% of your portfolio, let's say, in one big moving stock? GoPro was, I certainly couldn't believe GoPro was doing what it was doing, but it got hot out of the gate, but then had a lot of song and dance here, a 10-week base, an 8-week base back and forth, breaks out in huge volume. Again, you know, you get right across the top, you wait for that one-day explosion with the volume, and you just go right then. Pyramid right in, and you're done. So that's how I use eSignal. And
hey, folks. This is Dan from eSignal. Can we start queuing up questions for Dan to respond to at this time? Go ahead and type it into the chat box, and we'll respond accordingly to Dan's questions you might have for Dan.
I don't use it.
Eldrin has a question. Okay.
Do I use any sort of form of them? Go ahead, Ben.
So it looks like LJ said a question of, do you use options at all?
I rarely use options. There are one or two times a year I may use options, a small number of options, deep, very deep. Let's say a stock is $400. I might buy the 350 calls or the 300 calls, $50 to $100 below the price, current price, out about weeks. And that's about
okay,
it.
So
and I buy only when the stock is breaking out, and then reduce as the stock moves up. And that's it. Otherwise, you're going to get killed on options.
Okay. So next from Andy Huey, when is the next East Coast seminar?
East Coast seminar is 2016. My next seminar is 2015 in San Francisco, May 2nd of 2015 in San Francisco. I only do one per year. We get about 150, 140 people per show. It's a very popular show, sells out every year. That's good.
Teresa has a question. How do you know when to get out? I'm not sure if that's a open-ended question, but I'll leave that to
response. Well, I mean, you know, a stock can run for either get too extended too quickly, in which case you want to reduce 50% or so. Yeah, let's say a stock runs 20 or 30% of its after breakout in 3 or 4 days, sell and lock in some profit. You don't wait around for the stock to return and then you don't have any tax to pay. You know, you want to be able to pay your tax because you took a profit. But stocks can run for a period of time. They can run for, you know, 6-8 weeks. Some can run 12 weeks. You know, if you scale out all the way on up, you're going to make money all the way on up. So, you know, you don't have to say today is the absolute day. There are some daily bars that will give you that specific sell signal, which I go over in my seminar and only in my seminar. But, you know, as a basic rule, scaling out on the way up after 3 weeks, 8 weeks, somewhere in that time frame, you'll probably make most of the money the stock is going to yield by doing that.
Okay, so let's queue up the next set of questions. It looks like from Don 2. Dan, are you... Let's look at Cam's question. Cam, do you typically go to cash after big market run-up like the one we are experiencing now?
It depends on market behavior. I don't typically go to cash merely because the market is running up. In this market, I'm more or less in cash. The market is very extended too. Most of the earnings weren't that special. A lot of the breakouts are failing in this market. The market is dominated by only a couple of stocks, such as a Baidu, an Apple. So you really have to be very selective. Also, this market has thinned out in its volume. So being able to swing in and out of 100 or 150,000 shares, for me, is, you know, I'm not sure I can keep enough Tums at my table right now, to tell you the truth. Back in 2012, when Apple made a big run, you know, that stock had huge volume, and that stock soared. Broke out at 400, I just piled in. And, you know, I wasn't out till about 4:30 or so. 5:30, I'm sorry, and then the stock based up again, and then broke out again about 5:30 or so, and then ran to 7:05, and then I'm checked out about 10 bucks from the top. So, you know, I kind of wait. I would have to say 80% of all the money I've made over the years has come from one or two stocks per year, just trading those one or two big movers per year, and to me, everything else is not something that I'm interested in, even though they chug away. If you have 1,000 shares, you're buying 500 shares, and you know it's more manageable and easier to get out. So for me, I'm a little bit different. I like to trade big size, and I just can't stomach a lot of these very thinly traded. So that's just not my style, and you have to really work with what works for you. And so in time, you figure out what works, and the more your account grows, you'll start running into troubles getting in and out of stock, and then you'll have a better sense of why I have my portfolio is set the way that it is at this particular time. So you just it's something everybody has to deal with for themselves. Next.
Great question. Next question from Thomas Cox. So he provides a hypothesis. If you're new to trading with 5,000 in capital, what would you recommend to get started? And how much capital do you think is good to trade for a living as well? So Dan, if you want to kindly respond to this?
Yeah, so you need, I think five, you're way undercapitalized to even start. I would say in this market, probably 20,000 would be good. I wouldn't do any trading until you've read How to Make Money in Stocks. At least 3 to 5 times at a minimum. I've read that book 35 times in a 6-year time frame. I don't read it anymore because I absorbed everything. And it really was such a life-changing book. I highly recommend it. I think that Bill O'Neill was absolutely brilliant, is brilliant. And you have to read it over and over and over and over again. And then you also have to trade while you're reading it over and over. And because then you'll figure out that's what he was talking about. And that's basically what I do with my newsletter is I teach pattern trading, using patterns, using tight stops, getting the big winners at the right time. I may at times give you a select call on options, which I did back on Apple on its big run. But, you know, you'll see how quickly things can reverse. For some unknown reason, the Russell is getting into a triple top situation. And out of the blue, on Friday, biotechs just turned and plunged out of the blue. Meanwhile, you have strong moves in technology stocks. And Netflix turned up. GoPro's kind of basing still. Tesla's up for some goofy reason. They're a good company, obviously. They can't meet demand, so earnings and revenues are going to be flat. How do you rally a stock where earnings and revenue are going to be flat and they missed? It's I just don't get it. So I have a tough time trading that stock. But there are many others out there. So I would not trade. If you're going to trade with your cash, 5,000 or 10,000, I would just be doing 1 and 200 share lots, learning how to set your stops. And every night, you know, flipping through charts and understanding your mistakes and understanding, well, that chart and that bar, that's a weak setup right there. I really should not have been in that. It didn't have the volume. It didn't really close up strong. You should release get onto some service that gives you earnings increases. Learn how to read earnings for momentum trading, not for value trading. There's a difference there, and I do teach that at my seminar. So there are lots of things that you have to learn, again, and you're a rookie. You have to understand you're a rookie, and, you know, getting advice from somebody else on what to buy is probably the fastest way to lose your cash. And, so that's you know, you really have to understand the chart, the short-term pattern, the overall pattern, the earnings, the market itself, and before you start making really good money. I got totally cleaned out. I made 400% of my money back in 1990, and all of a sudden I ran into my first market correction. It just about wiped me out. I didn't know what market correction was. Don't they signal you and send you an email that a market correction is coming? Oh my God, I just was decimated. You know, that just doesn't happen. You have to read the charts. The charts will tell you when this is going to happen.
So Dan, you can imagine I'm gonna pose this last question. It's an interesting one from Nick S. So Dan, what about eSignal gives you an advantage?
Well, you know, I love their software. I love their feed. I love the spontaneity of the product. Has everything I need at my fingertips for quick, easy access to see whatever it is that I need, and all my questions about a stock technically are answered with volume, price, behavior, charts, everything is answered at the click of a button. With inside of 10, 15 seconds, I have all the information I need to make the trade or not. I love eSignal. I've traded with it for 15 years. I couldn't live without it.
Thank you, Dan, for that awesome endorsement. Hey. So, folks, at this point, I'm going to go ahead and officially close out the webinar. I appreciate everyone who has been here at the beginning. A few closing remarks. I would like to thank John, Darryl, Howard, Ron, Jan, and Dan for taking the time out of their Saturday to spend time with us. I would also like
Pleasure.
To thank each and every one of you for coming to today's webinar. I hope you found this webinar beneficial. If you have any follow-up questions, please do not hesitate to contact us. Again, please send an email to eSignalProducts@interactivedata.com. That's eSignalProducts, one word, at interactivedata, one word, .com. In the subject line, put attention Ben David, and I will be more than happy to route your questions to the appropriate presenter for any follow-up questions you may have. And as a reminder, and as a thank you, you will be receiving a recorded copy of this webinar for attending. I'll also work with my dev team to post all of the presentations on a hosted location so that we can include them as links for you to review the PowerPoints as well. We hope you have enjoyed Back in Black, and will join us again.